We're going to shift our focus now to the latest concerns around Boeing and aviation safety more broadly. The aerospace giant remains on the hot seat over important questions about its manufacturing and production processes. The head of the National Transportation Safety Board, Jennifer Homendy, told lawmakers her investigators still do not know who worked on the Boeing 737 door panel that blew off an Alaska Airlines flight back in January. At the same time, the New York Times reported this week that Boeing and a key supplier, Spirit AeroSystems, failed a number of recent FAA audits. Boeing reportedly failed 33 of 89 product audits. FAA Administrator Mark Whitaker was asked about that on Monday.
We've increased our audit and our oversight of Boeing pretty significantly since January 5th. If we see something that requires us to cease production or pull something down, we'll do that. But we're continuing that oversight, and we're working with Boeing and demanding that they come up with a very detailed plan within the next 90 days to fix the quality issues that are out there.
Equally unnerving, a series of problems on flights in just the last week, including several on United Airlines. There have been half a dozen incidents for United, including one flight that had to turn around after an engine caught fire. And on Monday, a flight from LATAM Airlines dropped suddenly and temporarily in midair en route to Auckland. The plane landed safely, but more than 50 people suffered injuries. One passenger woke up suddenly to the scare.
I look up, and he's full length, facing down, looking down at me. And I looked ahead, and there's another guy in the ceiling, and there's two people flying through the air, going across the aisles.
And let's bring in our aviation correspondent, Miles O'Brien. Miles, it's always great to see you. So let's start with Boeing. This Boeing audit conducted by the FAA revealed that the company failed large portions of that evaluation. The company failed 33 of 89 audits after that door panel flew off the Alaska Airlines flight back in January. Put that into context for us. What more can you tell us about that?
Well, Jeff, those numbers are kind of stunning. The Boeing CEO early on used the euphemism quality escape. That's a lot of escaping. And that causes a lot of concern about what's going on that factory floor at Boeing. But also, very importantly here, you have to ask the question, where was the FAA in advance of all this? Why weren't these audits ongoing? As we have discussed several times, Jeff, the FAA has moved to a system where manufacturers do their own inspecting. Obviously, we have a problem there with a conflict of interest, potentially. To the extent that there are FAA inspectors involved, in most cases, they're requesting and receiving paperwork, not necessarily putting boots on the factory floor and laying their eyes on potential problems. So when the FAA administrator says they need to rethink all of this, it's a big rethink, because the way it is done right now clearly is allowing a lot of safety problems to escape into the market. And that's not what anybody wants to hear.
And the NTSB seems to be saying that Boeing isn't cooperating. How do you interpret the comments from the NTSB that they don't even know who was working on that door panel that flew off?
The NTSB would like to speak to the machinists that actually did the work on that door, which escaped from the Alaska Airlines flight. What happened? What did they do? What did they not do? What were on the checklists or not? And it's not a criminal proceeding. This is just an effort to understand what went wrong. This is how aviation gets safer. You learn from it and you make better rules for the future. But Boeing has so far blocked that effort. And you have to ask the question, why would the manufacturer do that? What wouldn't it be in the interest of aviation safety for those machinists to speak to the NTSB so that lessons can be learned?
We also learned this week that that Alaska Airlines flight was scheduled for a safety check that same day the door panel blew off, and that there were engineers who were concerned about warning lights before that. You're a pilot. Are there cases where it's okay to fly when warning lights are going off?
pilots have something called a minimum equipment list. It's the stuff that you can, that might be not working 100% correctly, but you can still dispatch and take off with. These lights on their own were in that list. In other words, you could fly and get it to maintenance in a reasonable course as opposed to grounding the aircraft. In retrospect, maybe that wasn't great. However, there was no other signs or symptoms of trouble with the pressurization system. And when I say that, either the crew or passengers would feel popping in their ears or hear a rushing of wind. None of that was occurring. So for all that engineer and all those machinists knew, it was just a bad sensor. And so the decision to wait until it got to Seattle, in retrospect, was probably an okay decision.
Here we are some 3 months later. Do we still know enough about the circumstances surrounding that Alaska Airlines flight?
We're getting there, but I mean, it would be, again, it would be nice to talk to all the parties involved, see exactly what happened, exactly what they were thinking. You know, everything that is done in aviation has a checklist, and the process of building aircraft are no different from that. This particular activity, taking off that door to fix some rivets, was not in the, you know, the system, so to speak. It was kind of an ad hoc move to make a fix. Those are the kinds of things, that kind of detail is really important to understand, how that slipped through the cracks and how those bolts weren't put in place.
And Miles, amid all of this, a veteran Boeing employee, a prominent whistleblower involved in quality control, he died by suicide. What more can you tell us about his case and his deposition?
Well, John Barnett worked for a long time in the South Carolina plant for Boeing, which produces the 787. And his whistleblower case has revolved around quality control issues at Boeing. And at the core of his testimony is the idea that parts that were taken out of the production line by workers concerned that they weren't up to snuff and put off to the side were not properly evaluated, but rather were put right back onto aircraft that are now flying around the world. That's a big concern, and that deposition was a very heated one from the company officials. Now, what that might have to do with what happened later, we don't know, of course, but it's a tragic end to John Barnett's story for sure.
And as we mentioned, there have been a series of incidents involving United flights and others involving Boeing planes with different airlines. How concerning is all of this, big picture?
Yeah, it's kind of all over the map, Jeff. You have cases where wheels are falling off. That could be attributed to maintenance. An aircraft taxiing off a runway, probably pilot error. An engine flame out, that's a manufacturer, CFM, that makes the engines. And then you have a 787, which had a precipitous fall between Australia and New Zealand. What drives that all together? It's hard to say, except I will say this. The aviation industry was clobbered by the pandemic. It lost experienced people in every quarter, on factory floors, in control towers, in cockpits, and the people that screw on the wheels to airplanes. All those places lost experience during COVID when people retired. And so this industry, which is rearing and back and people are flying, is struggling to keep up with all that. And it is worrisome.
Miles O'Brien, appreciate your insights as always. Thanks so much.
You're welcome, Jeff.
This morning, police in Charleston, South Carolina, tell NBC News they are aware of the death of a former Boeing employee turned whistleblower. 62-year-old John Barnett found dead on Friday from what the coroner calls an apparent self-inflicted gunshot wound.
So this is my retirement plaque.
Barnett retired from Boeing in 2017 after working as a quality manager for more than 30 years. Since his departure, he has taken legal action against the company, claiming he was retaliated against for raising safety issues internally, issues that Boeing denied at the time. Back in 2019, Barnett sat down with Today, describing a haphazard safety culture at Boeing.
From day one, it's just all been about schedule and hurry up and just get it done, push the planes out. We're behind schedule. You know, we don't have time to worry about issues that y'all bring up.
In 2017, the FAA released a review upholding many of Barnett's concerns. With regards to his sudden death, the company released a statement writing, "We are saddened by Mr. Barnett's passing, and our thoughts are with his family and friends." Production standards at Boeing are under intense scrutiny following a series of troubling incidents involving Boeing planes. The latest on Monday, when a 787 from the South American airline LATAM apparently dropped abruptly mid-flight from Sydney to Auckland, injuring at least 50 passengers and crew members. The airline says it's unclear what caused the strong movement on the flight. NBC News has also confirmed the Justice Department has launched a criminal investigation into Boeing following the blowout door plug on a 787 MAX 9 in January. The NTSB determined the plane left the Boeing plant without critical bolts that hold the plug in place. A scathing new FAA audit also found Boeing failed to comply with its own quality control procedures.
We're working with Boeing and demanding that they come up with a very detailed plan within the next 90 days to fix the quality issues that are out there.
Tom, we've also learned new details about that FAA audit. What do you know?
Yeah, that's right. So according to a slide presentation that was reviewed by the New York Times, Boeing failed 33 out of 89 FAA audits, 33 out of 89 failures over a six-week period. NBC News has not seen the slides ourselves. Spirit Aerosystems, which makes the fuselage for the Boeing plane, also failed multiple audits. And in one case, auditors saw mechanics using a hotel key card to check a door seal. Other mechanics were seen applying liquid soap to a door seal as part of the fit-up process. Boeing told NBC News this morning, quote, "We continue to implement immediate changes and develop a comprehensive action plan to strengthen safety and quality and build the confidence of our customers and their passengers." And they have some work to do. Savannah?
Absolutely, Tom. Thank you very much.
I thought I asked for an African-American to replace Terry.
You requested an Afro-American?
African-American. Jerry, you know I did. I put it in writing.
I didn't see it. You see it?
If you don't like her, you send her back.
Yeah, you tell her you didn't like her performance because she was white.
What? That's not the point.
Flipper, she's been here for 5 minutes. Give her a chance. This sounds dangerously like reverse discrimination to me.
Fresno State's basketball coach almost was fired a year ago. Here's the inside story. Fresno State was ready to fire basketball coach Justin Hudson last season, more than a year ago. After some early success, the team's on-court results were slipping. Recruiting and player retention had become an issue, with a long line of players having left the program. The university received notice from the NCAA about possible rules violations and other alleged misconduct by Hudson and his staff, stemming from a tip from an anonymous caller. Hudson, who signed a 5-year contract when first hired and received a 1-year extension after his first season, also was heading into the final year of the deal. A change would be costly for the university. Under terms of his contract, Hudson would be owed 80% of his salary, if not retained, about $440,000. Even so, there were reasons for the university to make a move. Fresno State decided not to fire Hudson. Here's why. The day before the Mountain West Conference tournament last March, attorneys representing the coach sent a letter to University President Saul Jimenez Sandoval alleging racial discrimination against Hudson, who is black, multiple university officials told the Fresno Bee. The letter implicitly threatened legal action against the university, said the sources, who requested anonymity because the school's investigation into Hudson's claim is still ongoing. Fresno State, which in the mid-2000s paid out millions of dollars in high-profile Title IX discrimination cases brought by coaches and athletics administrators, took a cautious step back. Rather than fire Hudson, the university initiated an investigation into his allegations, which, the sources said, revolve around a lack of financial resources for a basketball program that has fallen well behind in its conference. The Bulldogs coach, meanwhile, went back to work as a lame duck. Hudson's contract, worth $550,000 this year, expires on April 30. Fresno State, which has dealt with injuries to key players the second half of the season, has fared no better this season than last. The Bulldogs ended the regular season on Saturday with an 86-47 loss to Wyoming and an 11-20 on the season, 4-14 and in ninth place in the 11-team conference. They have at least one game remaining, Wednesday against Wyoming at the conference tournament in Las Vegas. If the Bulldogs finish with just 11 wins for a second year in a row, it will be the fewest in back-to-back seasons since 1986-87 and 1987-88, when the Bulldogs were 9-20 and 9-19. Financial reality or racial discrimination? Hudson declined to comment for this story, saying he would address his future after the conference tournament. The university also would not comment on the letter or next steps for its basketball program. Fresno State is fully committed to supporting a robust and competitive basketball program. We are unable to provide further comment at this time, a university spokesperson said. The university denied a public records request from the Fresno Bee for a copy of the letter alleging racial discrimination, citing its ongoing investigation into the matter. Building a case tied to racial animus or discrimination could be difficult for Hudson. It's true that the basketball program is woefully underfunded when compared to others in the Mountain West. Fresno State, which gets no share of parking, concession sales, suite leases or sponsorship at the Save Mart Center, ranked 9th out of 10 in the Mountain West in basketball expenses and was last in basketball revenue in 2021-22. The most recent year financial data is available for every public school in the conference. But those same financial realities are largely true for every one of the Bulldogs' sports programs, not to mention three that were eliminated in 2020 to cut costs. Even the Bulldogs' football program, the economic driver for the athletics department, had its operating expenses cut by more than $3 million over a two-year period, down to $14.8 million in 2019-20 from $18.1 million in 2017-18. Also, five players from the defunct women's lacrosse team are suing the university and its top officials for allegedly violating Title IX by depriving women athletes of equal opportunities, financial aid and treatment. The five signed declarations, which are exhibits to that suit, detailing claimed inequalities among sports programs on campus including unequal staffing, team travel budgets and overall operational support. Among the programs they said received better treatment, basketball. And, while Fresno State has not kept pace with basketball spending in the Mountain West, on its campus, the sport has come through the COVID-19 pandemic better than most. Basketball operating expenses increased by $597,189 from 2019-20 to 2022-23, according to the financial reports the athletics department submits annually to the NCAA. That is the second largest gain coming out of the pandemic for any of the sports programs on the Fresno State campus, behind only football. The Bulldogs women's basketball program, by comparison, has had its operating expenses increase by $182,005 over that same time period, ninth among all sports. What comes next for Bulldogs basketball? Fresno State conducted an investigation into the anonymous tips made to the NCAA, which was completed in August. The law firm Bond, Schoeneck and King did not fully substantiate any of the allegations from the NCAA source. It concluded, the allegations made against the men's basketball program appear to have little support from those closest to the program. The investigation into the claims of racial discrimination was still ongoing when the basketball season started in November, and a university source said then that Hudson would finish the season. This story was originally published March 13, 2024, 8:47 a.m.
I don't want to cause any problems, Lieutenant. I just want a new partner.
Oh, I understand. Your partner's a racist prick, but you don't want to stir up any bad feelings with him.
Well, he's been on the force for a long time. And
17 years.
And I do have to work here, sir.
So, you don't mind that there's a racist prick on the force. You just don't want him to ride in your car.
If you need me to go on record about this, sir, I will.
That'd be great. Write a full report. Because I'm anxious to understand how an obvious bigot could have gone undetected in this department for 17 years, 11 of which he was under my personal supervision, which doesn't speak very highly of my managerial skills. But that's not your concern. I can't wait to read it.
Now we have new details in the controversial firing of a South Suburban police chief.
Flossmoor's former top cop now suing the village for alleged racial discrimination. WGN's Dana Rebick joins us now with more on that. Dana.
Well, we learned today that back in October, former police chief Jarrell Jones complained to the mayor that he felt he was being treated unfairly by the village manager. Jones says after that, he faced retaliation he felt ultimately led to his firing.
When the opportunity came up to return to an area close to where I grew up to become a new police chief in Flossmoor, I was thrilled, absolutely thrilled.
Jarrell Jones was sworn in as the first black police chief of Flossmoor last March. Jones now suing the village and the village manager in federal court after his termination late last week. The mayor saying Jones' firing was performance-based due to what she called serious operational and administrative lapses under his watch. Jones' attorneys allege it was race-based.
Fundamentally, this complaint states that he was subjected to one set of performance standards because he's a black man. Not because he's police chief, but because he's a black man. And when he doesn't meet the white administration's expectations exactly to a T, they fire him.
In the lawsuit are excerpts from the village manager's performance reviews where she criticized Jones' manner of speech, saying he doesn't speak plainly or answer questions directly, and that he spoke too long at a committee meeting, failing to follow simple instruction to be brief. In another section, she said Jones did not listen to management's direction when he reached out to the school district inquiring about security cameras.
A full reading of those memos doesn't show one iota of a failing in law enforcement duties. Rather, it shows the kinds of race-based, hypercritical, micromanagerial criticisms I outlined before.
Jones, a 17-year law enforcement veteran, served as chief of the Macomb Police Department before moving to Flossmoor. Other black police chiefs in the region now stepping in to support him.
It is very alarming that in a matter of months, the administration determined that Chief Jarrell Jones made, quote, serious lapses in performance that rose to the level of severing his relationship with the community. It appears to us that the members of the Flossmoor community also share these concerns.
That Hazelcrest police chief is also a member of the of NOBLE, which is the National Organization of Black Law Enforcement Executives, which is supporting Jones. Attorneys are asking for a public apology, Jones' reinstatement as chief, back pay, and that village officials undergo racial sensitivity training. We did reach out to the village of Flossmoor for comment. They have not responded.
We lose our job, we walk the street all fucking night. How you gonna come home and tell a black woman you ain't got no money?
The death of an administrator at Lincoln University in Missouri earlier this year has sparked outrage and broader concern about the treatment of black women in higher education. Antoinette Candia Bailey died by suicide in January and left scathing letters where she alleged a pattern of bullying and harassment at the hands of the university's president, John B. Mosley. He is now on paid administrative leave pending an investigation. That came just weeks after Harvard's former president, Claudine Gay, resigned under pressure. All of it leading to a dialogue in academia about the particular challenges and pressures that black women face. We spoke to a few women about this as part of our ongoing coverage of Race Matters, and here's part of what they told us.
I'm Keisha Thomas. I'm at the University of Alabama at Birmingham.
My name is Dr. Candace Parrish, and I am currently a visiting assistant professor at the University of North Carolina, Wilmington.
My name is Shea Crowder, and I am an assistant professor in the Department of Political Science and International Relations at Loyola Marymount University in Los Angeles.
I certainly had not been exposed to a case as tragic as Dr. Bailey's, although for those of us in higher ed, especially those of us who are in senior positions or leadership positions, it is often a conversation around the chronic stress that we experience, the burnout that is experienced, but also the isolation that has followed us for our entire careers.
I was very sad that it had gone so far and that she felt like she did not have the resources or what she needed to overcome this sort of situation. And it just got me thinking about how many more people like myself actually experience these sort of travesties in academia.
I have absolutely experienced microaggressions with regard to the intersection of both my race and gender. In my entire time in my PhD program, there was never another black person above me or below me in American politics. And so it was a very isolating experience.
I have had those experiences, as have my colleagues, and it's not simply within our career. It starts in college and graduate school, and some of us even earlier. And so many of us, you know, see our education as an investment in our future and the futures of our families.
In my PhD program, it was a very, very tough experience in which there were several periods where I almost quit. There was a lack of support, and there were people who are in charge of my academic destiny as a PhD student who were manipulating things to go against my favor.
With everything happening in the world right now, when there are coordinated efforts on the part of, you know, individuals and institutions to attack the credibility of your academic work, and that's already something that, you know, brings anxieties, it can be, you know, particularly distressing.
Some of what we've talked about today, I've heard similar complaints from colleagues in law and medicine, industries across the board. I think higher ed is different because oftentimes we are so severely underrepresented.
I've actually stopped recommending academia as a valid job and community position to young people who want to pursue PhDs in teaching. I cannot vouch for their experiences, knowing the horrible things that I have gone through and how much emotional time and space it has taken.
Let's talk more about the particular stresses that Black women in academia face. Dr. Bridget Goosby is professor of sociology and co-director of the Life HD Health Disparities Research Lab at the University of Texas at Austin. Thanks so much for being with us.
Thank you so much for having me, Jeff.
Two consistent themes we heard from the professors who spoke with us: the sense of isolation and a lack of support. How does that square with what you found in your own research?
That is definitely commensurate with what we're finding in the work that we're doing right now, collecting data on Black women faculty on the tenure track, that they do experience forms of isolation, feeling like they are left out, networks are not available to them that are available to their colleagues, and the experiences of this lack of support that they have is definitely something that we're seeing in the work that we're doing.
And we should say that academia can be a high pressure, high stress, intense, some might say toxic environment, no matter one's background. What are some of the particular pressures that Black women face in higher education?
This speaks to what the women in the interviews were already saying, which is that we tend to be underrepresented. We make up 3.7% of overall of tenure track faculty in the United States. And so when we think about the high pressure of the positions of being faculty members, this means that on top of the stress and demand of being researchers, productive researchers, successful teachers, we also are in a space where people may not even recognize that we are the onlys, and that our experience is unique, and that we are more likely to experience racism and sexism, the intersections of those things in those spaces. We're also more likely to be cut out of networks because we don't fit necessarily, because we are so underrepresented. So there are a litany of different situations that make our experience as Black women unique in the stressful conditions that we face as tenure track faculty or faculty in higher education.
What do viable solutions look like at this point?
Well, viable solutions would be, one, identifying the stressors that Black women are facing and trying to mitigate the situations that they're in, protections for women who are experiencing racism, harassment, discrimination in these spaces, recognizing the fact that we come from a historically disadvantaged group and are underrepresented, which means that in these spaces, we are experiencing a lot of these kinds of stressors without the kinds, now increasingly possibly without the kinds of protections that we would like to see more of moving forward.
How has the conservative crackdown on DEI initiatives, diversity, equity, and inclusion, how has that affected the effort to attract and retain Black women in higher education?
So this is, you know, we're still in the nascent stages of this, but I will say that it is definitely something that's going to continue to have a chilling effect on the ability to recruit and retain Black women in academia. As was mentioned, can you really advise women to go into, Black women to go into these spaces when we're being publicly kind of singled out and discredited, and now without the kind of protections of DEI, which was, you know, as a system, was there to kind of help with increasing diversity and inclusion overall, being gone? This means that this could be a complicated situation for Black women to be in without having the kinds of protections that might have been put forward by DEI previously.
Dr. Bridget Goosby, we appreciate your insights and your time this evening. Thank you.
Thank you.
Listen, just touching on some real issues right here tonight. That's all.
That's all.
I want y'all to observe the excellence here. BX providing the sonics, my man, Minnesota. I'm letting the beat ride out because it's a part that I like when it come up, you know what I'm saying? I take this time to say what's up to my family. You hear that? You know what I'm saying?
For sure.
Just observe the excellence of that. That's many.
Hey, back. Fall back.
With the guitars. It's hip-hop music. It's good enough to speak for itself. And you got to do right by it. Minnesota.
Ain't no black people in Minnesota.
Uber and Lyft say they will stop operations in the Twin Cities after the city council overrode a mayoral veto on an ordinance boosting pay and protections for rideshare drivers. The ordinance would go into effect May 1st, but by then, Uber and Lyft claim they'll be stopping service to the area. While other states have raised minimum pricing for ridesharing, Uber and Lyft have only pulled out of one city, Austin, Texas. That was back in 2016, only to return a year later. To explain what happened and the lessons Minneapolis can learn from Austin is Sergio Averian, a writer with the website The Rideshare Guy. That's a platform dedicated to transportation news and resources for drivers. Thanks for your time, Sergio. Good morning.
Good morning.
The Austin story is different from the Minneapolis situation because it dealt with fingerprint-based criminal background checks, I gather. Still, there was the threat to leave, and that happened. What happened after that?
After that, about 9 months later, there was Uber and Lyft went to the state and had the state preempt, actually, a lot of these actions, and then they came back. But what happened is a company called Ride Austin came around about 3 days later with a very similar app and started operating in the city. Obviously, it didn't replace the scale that Uber and Lyft had at the moment, but, passengers were getting around and drivers were making some money. And then it kept growing. Unfortunately, when Uber did come back and Lyft did come back, they undercut the pricing of Ride Austin. And then, unfortunately, Ride Austin failed as a business.
So it's not a bluff. They did leave. And obviously, they realized they had to come back for business reasons.
Yeah, obviously. And then this is, I think what's going to happen here is it's going to be a little bit different than Austin. I'm pretty sure a lot of passengers are going to get stranded. I mean, there was a study made by the Governor Walz's committee, and Uber and Lyft turned over 18 million trips. So in the metro area, Minnesota, 18 million trips were done in 2022. So that's a lot of trips. Obviously, the cabs are not going to replace Uber and Lyft's demand that exists. And however, there are a couple of companies that I know of that could come in and take over some of the business. There will be people out of business, meaning as far as drivers are concerned, not make money. And there will be also a passenger stranded. But there's hope. There's 45 days to go, okay? I had an interview a couple of days ago. I said, I think everybody will settle down. There'll be cooler heads prevail. There's some negotiation time, and there's also the possibility, in which this I know as a fact, that Uber and Lyft may be going to the state level, maybe coming with their own ordinance or law at the state level, and that will preempt the one that was done at the city level. So there's 45 days, let the games begin, I call it.
I'm wondering, the companies that you mentioned that could come into the Twin Cities, can they scale up fairly fast?
It's not an easy thing to do. Obviously, they have to onboard a lot of drivers, and they have to onboard a lot of passengers. But I don't think it will reach the scale immediately, but I think within a quarter or so, they will take over a lot of the business if Uber and Lyft decide to stay away for that long.
You mentioned the statewide solution. Governor Walz is advocating for a statewide solution, and there's this bill moving through the legislature. You mentioned that Uber and Lyft looked to the Texas legislature for help as well, and so this is something that it looks like it could go in terms of a solution to a statewide level.
Yeah, I think you will. And I mean, I am in touch with the companies, and I'm also in touch with a lot of the driver community on the ground. I think that's what's going to happen. I think there is already a bill being floated, which may be getting voted on as early as next week. And if that happens, I mean, Governor Walz, I'm pretty sure they don't want Uber and Lyft to leave. And I don't think the riders want Uber and Lyft to leave. A lot of people depend on them. And at some point, I think negotiations will start. Look, we still have 45 days to May 1, or if I'm correct, 45 days, yeah? Mm-hmm. So that's a long time. And there is a bill that's being introduced next week, and which is a statewide rideshare TNC bill. I think that will get voted on. And then although Mayor Frey did say that he doesn't like the preemption part of it, that states should not be ruling on city business, but push comes to shove, these companies have to do what they have to do. Although Minneapolis and the Twin Cities and the metro area is not one of their top markets, but they're big enough. I mean, there were 18 million trips done in 2022.
Right. Sergio, I appreciate your time. Thank you so very much.
Thank you. Much appreciated.
Good context. Sergio Avedian is a writer with the website The Rideshare Guy.
Said good context. That's what she said to Sergio. Context of White Supremacy. Gus T. Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Friday, March 15, 2024. So I have been told. Our weekly summit on neutralizing workplace racism, not for spectators. You don't have to do any grappling and praying and hoping that your employer leaves the city or the state because they don't like the new policies or they got to get you all a health care plan or raise or anything of that nature. You don't have to worry about all of that. You are compensated correctly. You have a valid health care plan and you work in a safe work environment. They don't terrorize you and jeopardize your mental health and well-being. You're able to go in. You are a valued member of the company, workplace team. Your pay is correct every time you put in your days off. They don't nag you and text and call and even, can you come in? You don't have, do you think you can show me? And they contact you when you come back to work, be it in the office, virtual, whatever. Whenever you're back on the clock, that's the next time you converse with them. If you figured out how to, you don't have to be a whistleblower, put your life on the line. If you figured out, again, how to get yourself in a safe environment where you are not mistreated, please do not be mum. Do not be greatest spectator. Let us know how you did that. Maybe we can do some mimicking. The number 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Man, I guess I have to tell you all what I was snickering at. So as I was giving out the number, I was thinking, like, man, it's been taking up so much time with Jonestown and studying all of that, getting information. so much tangential things related to Jonestown that I was going through the newspaper. I think I told folks, if you look through the newspaper, you can cheat and kind of start about the summer of 77, if you're looking specifically for Jonestown. If you cheat, start at the summer of 77, just look at the newspaper every day from there. You don't have to do it all in one setting. You'll see the entire system of white supremacy, racism, entire planet, no universe, really, and all areas of people activity. And a lot of Adolf Hitler, but all areas of people activity. Labor comes up a lot when you're looking through this, just over and over and over. I was thinking, because we had that segment on the black police officer in Illinois, was talking about racism that he experienced, and he was the chief of the police, Flossmoor, Illinois. Never heard of that one. I was like, dang, they just had that report, or not just, but I just saw the report in the San Francisco Chronicle, where it seemed like he might have been the only black police officer in Oakland. He quit because of racism. And I logged the information accurately, thankfully, so all I really had to type in was Oakland, and bang, there it is. Denial by chief Oakland cop to quit racism. One of the top black officers in the Oakland Police Department told a city commission yesterday that he is resigning because it has been shown over and over again that the department is a racist organization. Direct quote. The action of Sergeant Calvin Young, a 10-year veteran of the department, was the most dramatic to occur during 2 months of often volatile and acerbic civil service commission hearings on allegations that racism still pervades the department. Young claimed that key officers, including the levels of highest authority, have the attitude, if you are white, it's all right. What? Come on. Give me five, Dr. Welsing. Her birthday is coming up in a couple days. Come on. Come on. I heard that. What she said? She said, Negro, get back. Yellow, mellow. Brown, stick around. White is all right. It continues. But then he said, if you're black, you had better step. Well, I'm black, and I will not step back. Who is this guy? They killed him, I know. Police Chief George Hart said, I reject out of hand claims by Young or anybody else that the department has engaged in discriminatory practices. He didn't say racism. We have been involved, been very concerned for the concerns of minority officers and all officers. He didn't say we didn't practice racism. Any minorities, like what? What about that Negro get back part? What about that? He says, Hart said that during his 5 years as chief, the percentage of black officers in the 600-member department has increased from the 12% he inherited to the present 20%. I would love to know what the percentage of Negroes in Oakland is. Young, whose resignation takes effect December 15, is one of 10 black sergeants in the department. One black officer, a lieutenant, has a command position. Civil Service Commission Chairman Sandre Swanson called the resignation extremely disappointing. Particularly, he said, because Young was one of the very few black officers who might have been in line to move on to another command position. Hart said the Young's department performance has been fine, and that his record would certainly suggest his ability to compete for the next command opening that might occur. But Hart also emphasized that Young's claim of racism should not be given any additional weight simply because he chose to make some dramatic action. The key point is that doesn't necessarily make the facts any different. Swanson said, however, that it's something to take seriously, and it's quite a statement for Young just to walk away from 10 years on the force saying he couldn't take the same problems and the same people anymore. The commission began the hearings after the Oakland Black Officers Association, which Young helped found in 1969, complained it wasn't making headway in negotiations with administrators or protests that favoritism for assignments and promotions existed on racial grounds as well as others. Throughout the hearings, Hart has claimed that all testimony thus far has related to one-on-one situations that some individuals have perceived to have racial overtones, but nothing has been identified in terms of testimony, Hart said, that speaks to or suggests institutional racism, racist policies, or practices. The question of whether the hearings should be continued has become a very political issue in Oakland. And I will stop there, but the article, Oakland Cop to Quit Racism, December 8, 1978 specifically, for the date, so that would be about 2.5 weeks after Jonestown, if that means anything to you. Any hoodles, the reports that we heard at the beginning, the whole Boeing situation that's right here in Washington State. Big time news here, has been for a while. News across the country, across the world. They've been Boeing, the company, they make really weapons of war. They make these planes and such, but, you know. Anyway, so they've been in the news. They keep having all these incidents, I think, at least so far. Now, I know with the recent incident where the plane dropped suddenly, you know, who knows how many thousands of feet rapidly. They said that a number, I think 50 passengers were injured. I don't think they had any fatalities there thus far. Even the case where the bolt and the door and all that, I don't think thus far, and the wheel and all that, with all of these wacky situations, I don't think they've had any deaths. I don't think they've had a plane actually crash, like fall out of the sky and that type of thing. That said, man, that S word, S-A-F-E-T-Y, safety. Man, oh man, the system of white supremacy is not safe. We're on a plantation. We're in a concentration camp. We're in a prison. Pick whichever metaphor you like. Slave ship, all would apply equally. None of these environments are safe. At work, it's at least supposed to be the pretense that, you know, for these 8 hours or 12 hours or whatever it is, as long as the shift, we're at least supposed to pretend, you know, I'm not going to bop you upside the head, and, you know, we're going to get through this in a professional manner, and we might not even do any name calling, you know, for the most part. But we're going to get through this, behave ourselves, and not going to be violent. At least we pretend we're going to do that, you know, to a degree. You heard in the first Boeing report where they said it seems like a part of this problem is Sprint got to produce, get these parts out, manufacture, boom, 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 get this money, all that. And they said that there was a failure to comply with their own standards. That's something that I talk about all the time in terms of policy and procedure, especially as it relates to safety. You definitely want to know all of the safety regulations. You, any job that you work on where you could be injured, and that's, you know, most jobs, you want to be mindful. What are the safety regulations? Let's make sure that we are abiding by them at all times. That's one where I said you also want to be aware of the rules and regulations so you can observe when they are not being followed. That's both personal protection, because, hey, now, shouldn't be, if we're supposed to be on time, and you let, you know, Roger, Anthony, Craig, Susan, you let them, you know, come in late, 10, 15, 20 minutes late every day, and no big deal. I come in here 2 minutes later. Hey, Leroy, now, wait a minute now. You don't, you, well, come on now. equal protection under the law. Everybody is supposed to be, you know, abiding by the same rules, and they're supposed to be enforced the same, all employees. And if that's not the case, then they should break down why that's the case. If there's supposed to be discretion. But see, that not following the rules, we got to rush and do that. And we've heard that before. Places like warehouse jobs and that sort of thing, folks who work in Amazon, other places where you're loading and you got to, you know, get all these pallets filled or unfilled or whatever the case may be. You've got to rush, and they don't even let you get time to go to the bathroom. They said people are falling when they've got to use ladders and what have you to go up really high and are falling and or having a pallet or container dropped on them and that sort of thing. Or you got a forklift and people are driving reckless. You get hit with the forklift, that sort of thing. Widespread, just rush. Saying, dang, that might be, you know, why Boeing is, you know, plane is about to fall out of the sky every other day, it seems. Maybe that's related. Safety. And I mean, seriously, any job where safety is coming up, like, whew, that, in my opinion, that should be a red flag. I know, you know, jobs are important. We all have bills, expenses, especially if you have offspring, like, woof. Absolutely. But if you're on one of these jobs and it's unsafe, and you get killed, which does happen, they have OSHA and all that for a reason. If you get, or you don't even have to get killed, you can just get injured. Man, you get hurt on a job, that can seriously compromise your ability. Why were you doing this job in the first place? Oh, make sure you can take care of your children. Now you're seriously injured, they got to take care of you. And that's jeopardized the paycheck, so anything where you can see they'll use those old metaphors. They said, now they're talking about aircraft parts and such and saying we're not, you know, abiding by our own rules and regulations. And sometimes when we put these old bolts in or these parts in and what have you, and they're shuffling them back in and using them two or three times and all the rest of them, they said, hey, that's not up to snuff. What? What does that even mean, man? What are you talking about? Like, we're violating policy and procedure, which in this case, as they said, a criminal investigation. We might be engaged in criminal activity. What are you talking about? Up to snuff. That's another one, too. Now, see, once they start talking about a criminal investigation, everything that you say and do in the workplace, you kind of got to behave as though you are on camera. Everything that you say is going to be transcribed, and you might have to come before a court of law and give formal, I swear to white Jesus, I'm going to tell the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help me white Jesus. Mm-hmm. Right on, take a seat. All righty. Now, where were you on, it might come to that sort of thing. A year from now, 2 years from now, 5 days from now, it might come to that sort of thing. So, I would be in a habit of not being reckless and running off at the mouth and whatnot. I ask a lot more questions. What they say, that old, it's not even a metaphor. Maxim, as they say. I would do twice as much listening as you do talking. You got two ears, one mouth for a reason. In the workplace, I would do a lot more listening, and when I do open my mouth to do some chatting, it's going to be a high percentage of questions. Just getting clarification about things. So when they go back, they have to look at the transcript, they pull out the video footage, and all this, we got to investigate what was going on, and why weren't things up to snuff? What did you have to do with things not being up to snuff, Leroy? Let's investigate. Black brother told us last week, he said, let's look at the video. Hopefully, you will be in compliance and or asking questions about why things aren't in compliance. And then you really get a Dr. Welsing A+. They look at the camera, what happened? They got that coon over there. You see, always writing something down. What, you see that right there? Got the phone on me. Looks like he's taking notes or something. See, Keep an eye on that coon. Yeah, yeah. That's the way that you want to be when they go back and they got to review all this to see who is going to be blamed, fought, criminally prosecuted in all of this. Wasn't me. I followed the policy and procedure, and then I ask questions when we deviate from that. You also don't want to end up being John Barnett. Now, that was a white man. Said he worked there for all that time, was trying to change the culture of Boeing, and he dies suspiciously from suicide. I reckon they'll have a thorough investigation in South Carolina. We'll wait to hear back, but man, all of that whistleblower, that's a white man. That's a white man who dies under suspicious circumstances where a number of news outlets are looking at it like, you sure this was suicide? I'd have to look at how many millions, probably, retract Gus T. Ignorant, worthless Negro. I would have to look to see how many billions of dollars that, you know, we're talking about with all of this and allegations and, you know, it's a lot of money. That's another one to be thinking, especially you work for one of those big corporations where, hey, you know, don't want something to happen to you. They'll give you another one of those metaphors. Don't rock the boat. I thought we make airplane parts. Don't rock the boat. Okay, I'm going to be quiet. What? Somebody might, never mind. White sacrifice, as they say. And I mean, they might have said, hey, nobody died. They said the plane just dropped a little bit and they lived. A few injuries, 50. But, you know, nobody died. The tire fell off, nobody died. That might be the way they're looking at it, too. Hey, insurance will cover that and, you know, moving forward. Now we don't have that old whistleblowing John Barnett to worry about either. Moving forward. Let's see. Wait a minute. I had to do the math because they gave it quick. They said that Boeing, their record when they would come to do the safety inspections and what have you to see, you know, are we putting out safe aircraft for people to hop in and do their flying and all. They said that they failed 33 of the 89 tests. 33 of the 89 tests they failed. Wait a minute. I had to get my calculator out. I'm worthless Negro. So I get my calculator out. That means they failed 37% of the safety inspections that they did. That means they only passed, I had to get my calculator, I told you. That means they passed 63% of the time. I'm a worthless Negro from Virginia. I said that. Okay. I don't know. What class do you sit in where you can get a 63% and that's a passing grade? I've never sat in any class. I can think back. I've taken physics. I've taken calculus. I've taken English. I've taken gym. I didn't pull a Columbine. Little cowardly killer. I didn't get no F. I didn't get no D in gym. I ain't never got no 63, much less to get 63% and pass. What do you have to get for them to say, hey, wait a minute. This, you know, this is atrocious. What is going on here? You're trying to kill it, then fail. Grounding all this, you get your act together, straighten up and fly right, man. You have to, does it have to be 50%, 60%? 90%? Like, what? Give me the breakdown. That seems like a really high amount for aircraft. Like, man, if one of those comes out of the sky, it could be hundreds of, depending on where it drops at. I mean, if it lands in a residential area, I mean, we could be talking total catastrophe. It could land on a hospital. I'm being retarded, mate. I don't have, not in aviation. I'm worthless, ignorant, privileged black male, so maybe I don't know. But that seems really, if you work at McDonald's and they come in and they want to test you on the chicken nuggets, and they come in And only 63% of the time do you get the chicken nuggets right. Do you get to keep your job? I'm ignorant. I got to put it on terms where I can understand. But maybe I'm, you know, if anyone can help me grasp why that is acceptable, please fill me in. I'm still learning. Now, I did make an error, see. I saw the visual on this one. When they got to talking about the head coach at Fresno State basketball program, Justin with a T, J-U-S-T-I-N, Hudson, I saw they had a picture when I saw this report. I thought this was a white man who they were going to fire. He said, you all are practicing racism. And then they didn't fire him. I was like, wow, because I think I've seen that sort of thing before, and even successfully. This Justin Hudson is not a white person. He is very pale. I have made this error before where I've seen very pale non-white people who I thought this is someone who would be classified, accepted as white. Not so fast. So that was when I played the reverse racism to preface that, because I thought incorrectly this was a white person saying that you're messing me over because I'm white. That is not the case. Now, that said, I'm even more intrigued because I'm not really aware of, have you all seen that before? Where a non-white person, particularly a non-white male, could be a black male, is about to be fired. He said, whoa. Before you grab old Leroy and throw me out on the curb, in fact, I think you all are practicing racism. Whoa. Put Leroy's box down. Wait a minute. Woof. Did not think he was going to go and play the old race card. That is a sly one, Leroy. Okay. We'll keep you around until we figure things out. But that's okay. Security, put him down. Give him his key card back. It's a shrewd coon. We'll figure this out. We'll be back. We'll talk about it. Has that worked? Because I have never, ever, man, I would try that. Like, if that works, we learned one thing from Mr. Hudson. If they go to fire you or they're going to get you in trouble, at minimum, you should accuse someone, I suspect, Ellen, of practicing. Whoa. If it buys you a year, update my resume, get my act together until I can get out of here. But I've never heard that. Like, wow. You could just, y'all are being racist. Okay, you're not fired. Dang. Wacky times. Let's see. The police chief, as I mentioned before, Chief Jarrell Jones in Flossmoor, Illinois, where I've never been, although I did look incidentally, and they are right, Flossmoor, Illinois, the population is approximately 10,000, so it's not a very large place, but listed as 63% black, the population. So I don't know if he might, you know, be able to get a little bit more support, because this is an area with so many black people, if that means anything. But I didn't think that was noteworthy, but I thought what they listed for our privileged black brother, former police chief Jarrell Jones, they said that his speech was not clear. They had the audacity to accuse our black brother of not answering questions directly. Now, I have been around non-white people, many of them, many of us, but we don't answer questions directly either. But man, the undisputed, undefeated champions of the universe of not directly answering your question. Individuals classified as white. I'm sorry, Mr. Jarrell Jones, if you think you are good, if he's doing this deliberately, being circumloquacious, as they say, give you a 5-minute answer for something that could have taken 3 seconds. Nobody does it better than white men, white women, white children. He said that they didn't answer the questions directly. They said he was loquacious. Now, that is the total. What they normally do to us on the job is say, you're so quiet. You don't even talk. You don't even speak. You're not, you're not a good fit on the team. You just don't even chat with us. We don't even know if you're... That's normally what they say. That is a new one. For me, Leroy just ran it. Blah, 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 blah. Just chatting and chatting and chatting. Blah, 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 blah. Shut up. Like, wow. I did say, in the workplace, you want to do twice as much listening as talking. And I do say you want to be efficient with the answers. You don't want to just be rambling all day. If you can answer a question in 10 words, let's see if we can cut it to 9. You don't want to just be talking and talking and talking, especially to white people, even if it's non-white people in a work environment. But that, I mean, and all of these things are so subjective. That's what I mean about discretion. This is not a, you consistently come in 20 minutes late. That's very finite. We should have, you know, time cards, video cameras to show, yep, supposed to be here at 8 a.m. and you consistently get here, you know, 8:20, 8:25, 8:30, sometimes 9, whatever. Okay, we got that. Or other violations of policy and procedure. But I mean, you talk to the same thing if it had been you don't talk enough. But either one of those is what? How long am I supposed to, like, is that in the policy? Like, niggers are allowed, is it a word count? Or is it a, this is how long you have to talk? And anything over this, you're being a loquacious negro. Give it to me. Just let me know. That way I can keep a little timer on, or I can have a word count. Either way, and then I'll know, hey, that's something I need to work on. And the same thing would go for being direct about answering questions. Now, I mean, if I'm, you know, feeling cheeky for the day, like, hey, I wonder who I learned that from, not being efficient in answering questions. But I'll work on that one too. Maybe we can all work on that one. I'd make sure to look in the eyes of all the white people present for that. I got my Jim Jones glasses on, but I would make sure, you know how you do, you look over the top of the glasses so that we can see eye to eye on that one. We can all work on being direct and efficient in answering questions. Then I get back to my Jim Jones. Now, and then they said he didn't, you know, comply with requests and what have you. And the example that they gave was the police chief. I had to go back and look, like, is this the janitor? Does he work on the sanitation department for the Flossmoor Police Department? Like, he's supposed to be mopping the floor and he felt biggity and mannish negro and went and called the school to ask about the camera. Said, oh, wait a minute. This is the police chief. And he just called to ask about the cameras. Now, I guess if the white people told him, like, look here, Jarrell, don't ask the school nothing. We got it. We're going to go. We got the resource officers and all that. Don't be going down there trying to flirt with no white teachers and white women. Leave them alone. And then he snuck off and called anyway. Now, if it's that sort of thing, I guess. But, I mean, I don't know. That doesn't seem... But I'm not even thinking firing. That doesn't even seem worthy of a good write-up or tongue-lashing. Like, I mean, he called to check on the cameras. Okay. Did he try to, you know, bamboozle them, get them to buy, you know, 15,000 new cameras that they didn't need? Was he trying to get access to the video feed, to the female's locker room? Like, you'd have to give me something more than he called to check on the cameras at the school. Like, is that, that seems like it might be in the realm of something the police might do in a town. I'm still learning. We heard the segment Antoinette Bonnie Candia Bailey, tragedy, Missouri, black educator at a black HBCU, no less, and took her own life earlier this year as a result of white supremacy racism. We played a number of different reports and have talked about this and have talked about it. Dr. Frances Cress Wells, in her birthday in a few days, she said, if you are a victim of white supremacy racism, we do not qualify for black mental health. Don't even qualify for health. That's one of the reasons we have this broadcast. Being in these toxic environments, it can get to where it's this bad. Hopefully not. That's why I say all the time, like, you should notice, metaphor I use, red flags. These are serious warnings. When you don't want to eat, when you just have pervasive thoughts about the workplace. Like, you can't think, you can't focus on anything but the problems that you are experiencing on the job. It disrupts your sleep. Either you eat too much to compensate, or you stop eating at all. You don't even have an appetite. You stop doing the things that you enjoy. It can be lots of other things, but when you know, okay, this is really having a devastating impact on my well-being, some things are going to have to change here. Same thing I said before, you get injured on the job, your mental health is damaged. That is an injury. And it's the same thing I said before, like, for real, lots of us, unfortunately, might be aware of this. Man, your mental health gets disturbed, you're not going to be able to parent the way that you want to, or at least the attempted parenting that we might try to do. So again, there should be serious things. No job, I don't care how much, you know, the salary is, they got me one of them $1,000 chairs, man. Heat your buns when you sit in it, man. It's still wintertime technically, and woo-wee, man, I can't give it up, Gus T. Hey, no job. No job in the system of white supremacy racism worth your black self-respect, worth your mental health, worth your life, maybe even some other things you could add to. I'm just trying to cover some of the basics, but I mean, hey, system of white supremacy racism, even your so-called dream job, no, not worth it. Not worth it. Now, that said, they went in to give all the data, information about problems that black females face in the academy. I would be remiss. Now, once again, this could have been an opportunity. What are the stressors that black educators face in the academy? No. No. And this is the second time we've heard this report where they exclusively talked about black female educators. Now, I know we got that pipeline. Leroy doesn't get to go to college. I got it. Black females have outnumbered black males in the academy for decades. W.E.B. Du Bois talked about this at the beginning of the 20th century. More than 100 years. This is how white people run the plantation. Probably should say that last part for emphasis slowly. This is how white people run the plantation. But all of that said, why does that have to be consistently, predictably excluded when we get to this conversation? Because there are black male educators. Not as many of them as black female educators, but there are some. Did they not experience racism in the academy? Why do they have to be consistently excluded from the dialogue? You don't think Dr. Curry experiences racism? Really? Why is that? Black missing, and for labor specifically, now you've heard a bunch just on this broadcast where they consistently, we're going to talk about racism in the workplace, it will just be isolated to black females or non-white females. Why is that? Can you think of one report that just talks about black males and the problems that they experience in the workplace? Just one. We've heard several of those for black females and non-white females just in 2024. Again, haven't been that many days for 2024. I was asking, can you think of one report, period, like for all time that we've heard on black males and jobs? Oh, wait a minute. I can think of one. It was during COVID-19 where black males did not recover the same rate of employment after COVID-19. That was in New York, and they were talking like catastrophic employment numbers for black males. Privileged black males in New York City. That's one that I can think of. Black male privilege. You're supposed to get that jig together, man. Be working on the black male privilege jig. We're supposed to have that together by Juneteenth. We'll get out, we'll have fresh watermelon, and we will, bang, get to it. Be looking fresh, man. Beyonce put us out there. Warm up for the new concert tour, man. Get Anthony Broadwater to come out. He could do it with us, man. Black. Oh, he's still registered sex offender, I bet. So, anyway, and then they talked about the rideshare folks at the end. There was a lot of black people in Minnesota. It looked like these might even be black people who were not even born here having to do the rideshare. And I've seen that pattern where they talked about that in New York. You had a lot of black people, privileged, who were not born here. So they just try and get whatever job they can to make some money that was won. We look like, man, a lot of these folks are not making very much money doing this rideshare nonsense. And then they talked about they Uber and Lyft might leave if they adopt these policies. Say, we're going to pay George Floyd's cousins a few more nickels. I'm not doing any of that. Said even, in fact, relating to the job, they said if that does happen, hey, we got 45 days to see. Hopefully, they said cooler heads will prevail. Metaphor, but they said some people will be stranded. I wonder what people. What people in Minnesota, what people are going to be stranded trying to get to and from work? You think that might be George Floyd's cousins again? Number 605-313-5164, the code 564-943, pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. The email untiljustice@gmail.com. untiljustice@gmail.com. *61 for folks who have commentary, observations, questions to share. Let's see. Folks are getting their thoughts together. I'll get in email number one. Let's see. Email. We'll get in our update number one. So this has been going on for, I don't know, a couple weeks at this point, where privileged black male drives the school bus, get the, you know, our future off to school and such. And he had told us, so there were two incidents. The first one where a white educator accused him of shooting dice and children, I guess, on the bus. They were out on the field trip and he was having lunch, I think, with another bus operator. The children were doing, I don't know, field trip things. And they were having their lunch on the bus, gets accused of shooting dice. He goes to report this. And then I think they have another outing or something within a couple of days of this first incident. And I forgot what the second accusation was, where a different white educator hops on the bus and accuses them of, I don't even remember what it was. I'm sure he'll give us a reminder, but it was back-to-back where he gets accused. And he told us last week when we got the first update that he had written this up and charged them with accusing him of white supremacy. I think they had said that he said something. I don't remember it because it was such a false, crazy charge. I think that he had said something to this white woman to frighten her. That was what it was. He had said something or done something. I just said, shooting children, raping white women. That he had done something of this nature to a white woman. And so they went, they met with the, I guess, principal or whoever white authority in charge, and they were going to ask him to respond to all of these charges. And he very calmly, let's view the footage, which I thought brilliant. That is so common in with regards to labor and in the workplace, or really in general, but especially on the job, non-white people being falsely accused of things. And especially, it's almost 2030, there are cameras, especially if you do anything school-wise, there are going to be cameras all over the place. So for something of this nature, hey, we should have cameras. We don't need no witnesses and get 15 other people in what they say. Let's view the footage, which they did, and he had not done anything, no rapes, no dice, nothing. So we had the two incidents. He was going to give us an update on how things have been adjudicated now with two incidents. So he writes in, morning, Gus. On Monday morning at 9 a.m., I received a text message with a strange number. Sure enough, it was the white lady that lied on me. How did she get your number? the one who stated that I terrorized the students and made her feel uncomfortable, and also said I was fondling with my pants zipper. Are you serious? Said he, raping black male. Woof. Okay, maybe we put that into the black male privilege jig. We do some zipper. Anyway, the latter was told to me by my supervisor. I did not know she said all this. Anyhow, the tapes on the bus refuted all that. They don't have tapes in 2025. I believe she got my number and from the principal. That, I mean, let's remove the whole, you know, zipper, you tried to rape her. Let's put that to the side. If this was just, you know, we'll say this is Lisa. So Lisa works at the school, and I work at the school. I don't think I could just go to the principal and be like, oh, man, I worked with Lisa today. We were in her class. We had a great session. Do you have her number? Do you think I could get her number so that I could call her over the weekend? We kind of plan things out, see what we're going to do on Monday. I don't, like, I would not feel, yeah, sure, that seems reasonable, Leroy. Here you go. Here's her, like, what? I just, I don't know. It's to almost 2030. I don't think people just willy-nilly give out numbers and such. Like you, we would have to be on an intimate team where we have some sort of contact and we talk after hours, or we are carrying on business and, you know, we have group text chats and that sort of thing. Like, if it's not that sort of environment, why could you ask for her number? If this situation had just been, you know, random, like we were talking about onion dip recipes the other day, and, you know, Lisa said she had a great one. You think I could get her number so I could text her, remind her to bring me the recipe on Monday? Maybe you live in a universe where that would happen and they would give you Lisa's number. I think a lot of it. I'm at least have to check in with Lisa. She wants me to give out your number like that. Like, whoa, man, who said I want her to have my number? Anyway, well, I mean, it's not like you know, we don't have secrets in the system of white supremacy, racism, but I mean, dang, like I would feel violated, like for real, like anything like that. Like, I'm not even saying that we have to have a conflict, but especially after we've had conflict, I don't need you contacting me. What did I say at the beginning? I don't need you contacting me if I'm on vacation, if this is an off day, even if I'm just not on the clock. I'm not scheduled to be in until later this afternoon. I don't need you calling me to start my day off to apologize or anything else, or texting me. All of that is super inappropriate. Continuing. In her text messages to me, she stated that she wanted to clarify that she told my supervisor that she was just apologizing for making me late to my lunch hour. I immediately contacted my supervisor and physically showed her the text. My supervisor blew a gasket, stating that verbatim, that bitch is a goddamn liar, and now she is trying to make it seem like I am the one that is making this up. The main weapon of racist man, racist woman, racist child is deception. And I've seen that sort of thing in the workplace too, where they lie when they get caught. A white person, they get caught, so I don't want to get in trouble. I'm going to see if I can, what they say, pass the buck. Let's see if we can put the blame someplace else and just start doing some more lying. Now, all of this started with her lying. And lying for no reason. What is all that for? Oh, man. He could have gotten fired. Any era, really. It's 2024, really. He's just fortunate now we finally in the era where they got enough technology that, you know, a white woman saying that, we don't have you hanging from a tree. Like, before we get the rope, Leroy, let's at least look at the camera, since we got all this highfalutin HD technology. We'll look at the camera. We can actually zoom in. There is Leroy's zipper and nothing. Okay, we've looked at his zipper long enough. Yep, he didn't do anything. Okay, he's lied. I mean, we're just lucky, but I mean, he could have gotten fired easily for this sort of thing. Man. why does she still have a job? I'm thinking that too. Like, dang, you're lying on other coworkers repeatedly. Then you're lying about your lies. What they say, throwing other people under the bus. Why are you here, man? You're supposed to be working with children. What is all this for? And do you see how much time this? This is the other one I talk about too. Look at all of this time that we got to waste talking about this. We could be planning field trips, spring break, summer vacation, all kinds of things. How are we going to wrap up the school end of the year blowout barbecue bash? We could be doing all kinds of no. We ain't got lying race, so we got to go through all that. We got to sit and watch the video. Man, we got to go through the text messages. Oh, she lied about time and energy. And we don't even have anything to show for this. It's not like we get to the end of this and we got a sweater that we worked on and knitted. Like, that's what we're... Nothing. Nothing. Get to the end and hope I still got a job. Don't even get a raise. Nothing. He continues. Liar. My supervisor then made copies of the tapes. I don't think they have tapes in 2025, but whatever. And emailed it to me. See, can't have tapes and then email it to the HR manager, along with her, the white lady's original statements lying on me. My HR manager contacted me later on that day and told me that this situation is very serious. I think he could have gotten fired for the first portion of this alone. Easily. We're not even talking about the rest of it and lying on the coworkers and lying. Just the first portion of it alone. In fact, in my view, that's the sort of thing that they're talking about right now. Shouldn't this be a criminal act? And all the time that she wasted, like, yes, everybody should think this is super serious, if nothing else, all of the time and energy that you've wasted. Not to mention, we don't like having educators who lie, and particularly lie on their other colleagues. We're supposed to be in this together for the children. Very serious, and will be dealt with immediately. I'm to meet with HR on Tuesday next week. Just goes to show that when these racists get caught lying, they will try to implicate other people to rid themselves of any serious aspersions or culpability. Again, I will let you know the outcome. As a side note, when I walk around the school, all the race soldiers are looking at me like they could kill me. I guess these reactions are from the report I filed about the DICE incident, and now this new report about the lying I just filed. They are eyeballing me hard. Now, see, it could be they heard that first report and believed it. I mean... they might not even be on the second. I mean, that's the whole history of white supremacy. The first report, the Negro was reckless, eyeballing and shaking his penis at a white. But I knew it. That Leroy, we should not. Anybody got a rope? That Negro, I said it. He was trying to get me to it. They might not have even got to the second one. The dice tumbling. And actually, I guess that was the second incident. But whatever. You reporting the first fellow, the dice blowing, and saying that was racism and all that, I'm sure that did not make them pleased either. But man, a white woman reported that you did all this. I don't need the update. I don't need to check Snopes or none of that. Y'all don't need to come in and tell me, show me the video. I don't need none of that. Get on out of here. Raping, leaving, the Negro. Oof, man. All I got, we do not qualify for mental health. And that's a whole lot of us. Now, man, even look at that. Look at that. What did I do to be the object of all of this ire? I drove the children to the field trip as I was told to do. I was on time. I wasn't drunk. I didn't have fentanyl in my pocket. I wasn't lecherous. I was waiting out in the parking lot, eating my lunch. What did I do? What did he do wrong? I was wrong and lied on repeatedly. What is the way you handle this where they can give you a high five and a pat on the back? This was a misunderstanding. You bring in muffins to these white accusers, suspected racists. You bring them muffins. hot coffee, chocolate. Easter is coming around. You bring them chocolate Reese Easter eggs. You know, I want to apologize to you. Just, you know, if you felt some type of way, even though I wasn't shooting dice, but I just want to apologize to you, my white brother, for making you think that I might have been shooting dice. And I want to apologize to you, my white sister. I brought extra chocolate for you. And just to let you know that there's no way I would ever, I wouldn't even imagine myself trying to go to the bathroom or anything else associated with my zipper or genital region in your presence. And I would never even cross my mind. I'm so sorry. Is that what you're supposed to do? That's how you're supposed to behave here? Come on, man. To be expected, especially if this white woman gets in trouble. I would expect that to continue till the end of the school year. Oh, worthless Leroy. Got Lisa in trouble. I love Lisa. She made the best lemon muffin. They me talking in that sort of way. Like, let us know how it goes. Make sure that I miss anything. To be expected. There. Oh, yes, got it all. Let us know how it goes. I'm so sorry that you had to endure all of this. And I mean, this is just ongoing. Can't just drive the bus. Not that it would be a whole lot better, but I mean, he's not telling us. Like I said, he went to work and he wasn't wearing his seatbelt driving the bus. Same thing I said. It's not like he's telling us he's showing up late, showing up drunk. It's not like any of that. Showing up and he's not wearing appropriate clothing or what have you. None of that. Professional, safe. I drive the bus. I do what I'm told. Field trip time. Let's roll. Bus is ready. Gas in it. Let's roll. No. We got to have all of this and wasting time. And that's something else, too. I would tell your children to prepare for when you go in these workplaces. That's probably a lot of us. You're going to have to waste quite a bit of time countering racism where you're not getting work done. You're not furthering your career. You're not learning anything, at least about your job or your career. You're just attempting to counter racism. You're responding to white people practicing white supremacy. That is something I would tell folks to just prepare and think of that as a part of your job, unfortunately. Till we solve this problem, just have that in your brain computer. You're unfortunately going to have to, you want to see if you can minimize the amount of hours that you have to do that, but all of us, we are going to have to put in some time, unfortunately, on the job, countering racism. This sort of thing. You got to go watch the footage, write out a statement, talk to HR, all of that sort of nonsense. Go ahead and factor that in, part of how they waste our time and energy. Much obliged for the report, sir. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. If any folks have any suggestions, these type of situations where you have been falsely accused. Now, this is a lot better because these environments, there were cameras, which is soon, maybe it's going to be all of us, but at least for the time being, that is many of us work in these sort of environments. If anybody has any tips for how they would respond to these sort of situations where you might not have surveillance footage to support, help get you out of this jam, let us know. Or if you have any other tips for how you would respond. If anyone has any suggestions for the phone number component, I would appreciate that. Although I really don't know. I would have shared it. I don't really know. What can be done to neutralize that in terms of people just giving out your personal information. And we've heard that before, where other individuals classified as white getting access to your personal records, phone number, sharing that. It might not necessarily be a doxing situation where they go and try and dump this publicly to cause you more trouble, but just unjust networking. It might not be a situation, like I said. A lot of us, we don't necessarily work on a job where we have to talk to people on our cell phones. Certainly once we leave the job, we can just talk. They have phones in the workplace and we just use that. So it's not a necessity that you have your colleague's cell or home number or what have you. But getting this information, just that, like, should I choose to dox you at some point, I have the information at the ready. should we need to do some prank calls on you or whatever, or even for this, you know, I've lied on you and done all this other trifling racism. Now I want to pester you and, you know, I just wanted to call you first thing this morning to offer a word of prayer and my apologies. Like, are you serious, man? That's not how I need to start my day. Like, if you have any thoughts on that one, let us know. I think he said, person who wrote in said that he looked at the number and didn't recognize, so he was a little cautious about responding. Bravo there, but man, I don't really have an immediate counter, because for most jobs you would have to give up your address and personal, your phone number and what have you to even get the job. They would have that on file, presumably. Somebody, HR or some other white people, and certainly other white people who work there would have access, so you can't really have an expectation of secrecy, I would say, in the workplace to a degree. But yeah, folks have any thoughts on that one, you can share as well. Let's see. Folks are spectating, I reckon. If you are spectating, if we have any folks, if they have figured out things to do so that they are not abused, victims of violence, lying, false accusations, whatever it happens to be, you can avoid, minimize some of these problems. Do not spectate. Let us know. How did you accomplish this? If you can say, at minimum, saving us some time. We don't have to go to refute all these charges and take notes and sit through all these hours of security footage to watch and pick out what I did and didn't do. Let us know. This is what you do to make sure that sort of thing doesn't happen. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Let us see, if you have found yourself in that glorious space, no mistreatment in the workplace, and you're compensated and valued, you should invest. Get those notes together so you can share, see if we can replicate what you've done, and then make sure you invest. Hit the blog, racism-notes.blogspot.com, racism-notes.blogspot.com. PayPal button in the top right corner. Beneath the button, you'll see the links for PayPal, Cash App, Venmo. Huge thank you to all of the investors who kept us on the air for 15 years. Hopefully, we've been worthy of your time and energy. Offered a sentence, suggestion, or two to help minimize a few problems in the workplace, neutralize some of the ways that white people practice racism routinely against us on the job. Now, let's see, while folks are, just get their thoughts together. If you are having difficulties or what have you, feel free. If you have figured out you're not being mistreated and you have a thought to share there, let us know that as well. Let's see, other folks who dialed in with workplace racism, email number 2. Hi, Gus, Cal's audience, callers. Number 1, the non-white black female who no longer reports to me no longer works for the company. She returned from 3 months leave at the beginning of February and was on a phased return, which meant working reduced hours for a set period. The reality was that she was not around very much, and I only saw her once at a team meeting. Shauna sent an email Friday evening notifying everyone in the division that the non-white female who no longer works for the organization retired. Oh, well, good for her. She requested that only a few people be told, which is why the email was the first time most people would find out. The non-white female who no longer works for the company also refused a leaving gift or card. Well, deuces, that is kind of Neely Fuller Jr., right? Like, yeah, I didn't... You know, we don't need to do no tacky celebrations and party favors and cupcakes and all that. We still got the Rona and, you know, we've been doing sabotage and all this other old foolishness. Like, yeah, that's just, you know, you don't even need to tell him. You can tell him once I'm gone or whatever. But, yeah, let's just get back to work. I took some wellness days at the end of last week, and I did not get a chance to go through my emails before our team meeting. I got the news when right-wing Ashley mentioned it as part of her work update as she was taking over the non-white females' projects. I thought I misheard and asked right-wing Ashley if I'd heard her correctly. She confirmed, stating that the non-white female who no longer works for the company apparently told Shauna that she didn't want people who did not care about her to know and refused a gift several times. That is so gangster. I love it. But that is Neely Fuller Jr. Like, yeah, we're not a family, contrary to, you know, popular opinion. We just work together. And it's not like, I don't know, if she worked there for 40 years or something of that nature. But I mean, yeah, it's not even that serious. We work together. Right on. I'm blessed to get to retirement, and you know, I'm about to celebrate and do it up anyway. She probably had planned her whole retirement jamboree out anyway, so you know, whatever. Don't even worry about it. I don't need to. And you're not gonna swangle me on my last day either, don't you think? I worked all these years and planned everything out and evaded all the booby traps that y'all had for me to get to my last day for you to pee in my 7-Up. You lost your cotton picking mind. Get on. I'm good. I don't need no champagne. Cakes. Nope. I'm good. Thank you. Gift card. Nothing. Even the gift. No. Deuces. Love. Mr. Fuller did say that, though. I keep saying he said when he retired from the Bureau of Engraving and Printing, they tried to throw him a party. I'm even trying to picture that, like them going to put a party hat on. We got cake and everything. He said he just looked like. And he said he turned around and went back to his office. He said to say, not going to swangle me on my, I'm good. I don't need no cake. I'm good. Mm-hmm. She continues. This might seem like codification, but it's not. The non-white female who no longer works for the company worked there for over 25 years. Oh, she did work there a lot. I didn't think she worked there that long. Wow. The job was her identity, and she was very white identified. Last year, she told everyone it was her birthday so she could get some attention and was friends, in quotes, with so many people in the organization. My strong belief is that her anti-blackness got the better of her, and she disrespected Shauna and was disciplined. She would have struggled to get another role in the organization, and it was the second time in the year that she was reprimanded for her aggressive behavior. She came back to work but was unhappy to be reporting to Shauna, and not only is another black female manager, but would expect her to do some real work. I knew she was in her 50s when we first started working together, but I didn't know her exact age. I doubt she was at retirement age, but black doesn't crack, so she could have been, but I think she took early retirement. Now, that is interesting if, you know, what she said is accurate, that her level of anti-blackness is that much that it bothered her to have, you know, a black manager that she has to report to, but... I say that, but I mean, hey, Carter G. Woodson did write about that. He put a whole, like, subchapter is talking about that exactly. He says, yes, it does bother a lot of people classified as black that much and has for a long time, apparently. Yeesh. She continues. Two, I've been experiencing black problems. Dr. Ruby Lathan told us about the book Drink More Water. I forgot how to get the full title, but that literally back problems can be caused by not drinking enough water. Drink more water. Drink more water. That would be a big one. Also, I wanted to find out about the massage service on site. I found out they also do nails, eyebrows, eyelashes, waxing, hair, and spray tanning. Spray tanning? What? Spray tanning? Spray tanning? Once, like, at the... So, we're upstairs. We're doing our meeting. We got a luncheon at 12 o'clock. And then I got a 1 p.m. for my spray tan. And then I come back. I'm like, whoa. Just as bronze that you want. Wow. I'm same complexion as you. Three times, Dr. Francis Cresswell. I had been speaking to Shauna about the massage and hair service, but at that time, I didn't know about the rest. We joked about the fact that they probably didn't offer black hair treatments. They don't. I brought her a leaflet more in jest than anything else. They don't have black hair care treatments, but they got spray tanning. I put it on the desk she was using, which was next to racist suspect Brian. Being white, he couldn't resist acting like a racist and looked at the leaflet. Realizing what it was, he then started joking about using their services. He made what he thought was a joke and started laughing hard, which confused me as I didn't think it was funny. But I didn't really hear what he was saying or didn't understand it. He then said, "He's a modern man," and continued laughing. I commented that he made himself laugh and was thinking to myself that he was a fool. He replied, "And I made you blush." He then realized he said something sexual and walked away. Yikes. Now I'm just curious for my own. It's like, what was he talking? Like, was he talking about getting a waxing? Like, what? What is going on? Like, what? Man, that is on the slide. Now, I know this was not the intent at all, but just indirectly, this is why I say in the workplace, I never bring up anything but what are tasks, things that are related to the job. We're not going to have random, you know, just casual conversation about, you know, the local sports team, food, our children, families, none of that, because as Fuller has said, it doesn't get any better than tacky. Case in point. Now, nothing really needed to be said from what I understand. I didn't get to see the flyer and all that, not that I need to, but I'm just saying. From what she explained, nothing really needed to be said. Okay, they got the hair treatments, waxing, massage. Okay. Back to work. Why do I need to comment, make a funny, be slick on this, all of that? Oh, I got to say something slick. And she said she's not even paying attention. She's doing her own thing. And he's still just going up more for his own amusement, because she said, "I'm not even, you know, paying attention." It's not like he's coming over here always talking to Brian and, "Oh, you're so funny, Brian. Stop it. Stop it." That's not even what was happening. And he goes on with all of this and we, "Oh, and I made you blood. Look at that." Doesn't matter. We've heard people where they've been talking about food. We're having a totally, you know, logical, reasonable, G-rated conversation about food. Nobody was being mistreated. They weren't mocking somebody for whatever they were going to have for lunch or whatever the case. Just talking about food casually, and that ended up being a means to get in a racist joke or whatever, or to mock and name call and all the rest of it. So, to minimize all of that, we're just talking about the workplace. Like I said, she wasn't even talking to him. I just put the flyer down, you know, to share with her. And I got to hop in and see that too. They hop in our conversations and what have you, jump in and hop in to be non-constructive. Common pattern. Let me make sure I didn't miss anything. So Brian, so he made that one, made you blush, then he realized he had some sexual, walked away. He made another sexual comment this week, ending his statement with, "I probably shouldn't say this as I'll end up with an HR complaint against me. Both occasions took me unawares, so I couldn't put him in check. The next time I will, and also let Shauna know." That sort of thing would stand out too, like that. You know, I should, in the workplace especially, when they start, I mean, you know, I shouldn't, they look around, you know, "I shouldn't say this," but that's one, that might be one where you can preempt it for now, especially they've shown a pattern, I'm gone. Yeah, or Walter Beast III, he's like, cut him at the knees, like, well, before you even get started, Brian, I'm not interested. Thank you so much. I'm sure it's going to be funny, but yeah, I don't even participate in jokes like that in the workplace. And once they start gossiping about other people, if they're talking bad about other people, anything seems like it's going to be some tacky, racist joke, anything like that, feel free. Go ahead and interrupt that, especially if they've shown this before. Like, you can get me one time, right on, got you, fooled me once, shame on you, but get fooled, you can't get fooled again. See? That would apply in the workplace. So, Brian, you got one time. After that, like I said, you don't want to say anything? You don't have to, and they will get the point. Brian comes in, and he's, oh, look here. Look here, Leroy. I said, hey, wait a minute. You just get up and go to the bathroom. You don't have to say anything. You don't have to tell him, oh, I got to go. I'll be right. Just get up, go to the bathroom. And I would make sure to stay in there a good 5 minutes, even if I'm just breathing. Francis Cress Welsing. Come out, Kanban. You just get yourself centered. Get myself back on track. You can even be thinking, now if I go back out there, Brian's still there. Boom, this is what I'm going to do. And then you can just tell him, hey, Brian, I got a lot of work to do. I don't really have time to hang out today. If you got something work-related, you need help on a project or anything, please let me know. But, yeah, I don't really have time to get into all that right now, so I'm going to get back to work. I'll talk to you, though. Professional. Courteous. I think what I just said, I could live with that. If they got that on, you know, Alexa or somebody had their phone on and recorded all of that and they go to the CEO, White, whomever it is, and that's what they got me saying, that's what I'm supposed, I mean, yeah, what, I got a project to work on? We supposed to, you know, he's mad, particularly if they got the recording of what Brian been saying before, like, yeah, I got, you know, work to do. I just don't do a lot of crudeness. I'm not a bawdy, vulgar person. I don't tell those type of jokes. That's just not my type of humor. I'm just a, you know, prudish, stay on the job type of person. Isn't that what you want for the company? Question, Lane. But I would just stop, and I've never, somebody would have to tell me that would be up there with you talk too much in the workplace. I've not heard that one. A black person being accused of that in the workplace, I have never heard a black person get in trouble, or a non-white person, period, get in trouble because I was trying to stay focused on my task. This person was making crude, inappropriate remarks, and I didn't want to engage in that. I was trying to stay focused. Oh, no, that's not, I've never heard that. Any hoodles. But yeah, and that's another one I would say, be paying attention when you note that. They just got it, because we've heard that from a lot of folks where they work with a Brian. They work with someone. That's what they look forward and love to do. They don't ever come seek out you, black person, to say something constructive. Like, even if they were going to come and talk to you about things that were not workplace related, but, you know, hey, I remember you said, you know, you got relatives in Oklahoma. I just saw where they had, you know, round trip airfare, no stops, for $50. You want to go, you know, visit your family, what have you, got some time off coming up or what have you. I mean, 50, can't beat that, $50. Here's a website and information. Check it out. You know, if it doesn't work out, oh, well. But, I mean, hey, $50, man. Wow. Like, all right, Brian, right on. Thank you, brother, even if I'm going to go or not. But that's not what they do. They don't come, you know, hey, cut your car insurance in half, you know. They don't come with that. Show you how to get a raise. Boost your salary. They don't come with that. Did you? They don't even come. Hey, did you know they had massage service downstairs? Employees get 50% off. They don't even come with that. Like I said, they want to come and give you some old crude sexual joke or something. Some old racist joke and old not. Or just gossiping, talking bad about other employees, like all that. I'm good, Brian. Thank you. Back to work. Much obliged. Love that, too. Once you can do that, once you are studying your counter-racist code, how you individually want to function in the workplace based on your personality, how you understand racism and, you know, the circumstance, your work circumstances, you already know. This is what I'm going to say. He comes in on that foolishness. This is what I'm going to say. He comes in and tries that next time. Boom. This is what I'm saying. Or even if I'm not going to say anything, because that's one you can get him to. Brian comes in to talk all that fool talk, and he's sitting over here. Look here, Leroy. And then look, and he's doing all that. And you look at him, serious. No smile, no chuckles, nothing. I'm just looking him straight in his eyes. I got to get back to work, Brian. You hit him with that one two or three times. That's for the people, like I said, if you're not a big talker person, you don't want to, you don't feel as comfortable telling somebody, excuse me, Brian, I got to get back to work. I don't have time to talk about it. You don't feel as comfortable saying that? I'm going to get back to work, Brian. That's even shorter, man. They will get the point. And they might treat you the same way that they did Dice Roller, our bus driver, where he got all the white people like, he don't laugh at my jokes, man. And Brian, I'm the comedian. You don't laugh at, I'm trying to be the Kevin Hart of the office. You don't snicker and laugh at my jokes, man. What's wrong with you? You nigger is supposed to be entertainment committee, man. What's wrong with you? Get back to work, Brian. You hit him with that, I guarantee you. Either you give him about two or three of those, maybe even one. Max two or three. He'll get the point. He'll stop doing that. Or she. You could even use that one for victims, too, because I've heard some of us, got bad habits. Much obliged. The email again, untiljustice@gmail.com. untiljustice@gmail.com. The number, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943 pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. If anyone has an idea, any sort of suggestion, because my peanut-sized Negro brain, I really think like it's no, there is no opt to get most. I can't imagine System of White Supremacy on this plantation. You go to get a job, and a white person is not going to have your address and number. Most of that would be on your driver's license. I think for even your dream job, I would think, like, if you got, I don't know, you got to be play for the Kansas City Chiefs, win a Super Bowl, brain damage and all that. I think they need your driver's license. Don't you think they get Patrick Mahomes' driver's license? They got to confirm that you're a citizen, you didn't hop the border and all of that. HR, they got to have a file, your name. Normally, they got to get your address and phone number. So I don't think there's getting around that. If anyone has a suggestion for how you would keep that sort of thing from happening, please let, outside of having a burner phone, I guess, if anyone has a suggestion for that one, that would be great. But at least at this point, my peanut-sized Negro brain thing, and even if you did, in the System of White Supremacy, I suspect if it's a smart enough white person, if they know the correct powerful white people, even if you didn't give them your phone number, they could probably still get your phone number. I could be wrong, but if someone has a better suggestion for that one, please share. Let's see. Non-Clemson dad, Mama C, 00 Dimples, should be with us.
Hello, can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
All right, so I'll begin by answering your question. First and foremost, the people in my immediate department do have my personal cell phone number. And in my experience thus far, this has never been an issue. And of course, I'm the only black person in my immediate department. But again, this has never been an issue. I will say this though, after I got my engineering license, my personal information is now technically, well, legally public information. So for example, if you wanted to look up, whether or not I'm a licensed engineer in the state of South Carolina, once you find that information, you will see my personal address. And I was shocked to first learn this when I looked up, my information after I got licensed. But then, I started looking up other people who I know that are licensed. And yeah, their personal information is just all on the internet if you know where to look for it. This is not something that is advertised, but it is definitely accessible if you look. Next thing, I'm currently in a real estate course. The featured property for the project is a parcel or two parcels that was just recently bought by a black male who is a who owns a construction company here locally. And of course, he's a developer as well, too. And right now we're about, I think, 8 or 9 weeks through the 12-week course. And, the first 7 or 8 weeks was professional developers coming in and giving presentations, which also included white people and non-white people, including a couple of black professionals, like one that was a licensed architect, which I really did appreciate. But it also talks of the white developers. They talk very highly about the black construction company owner who now bought the property. And then recently, me and my wife and a couple other people were made aware that the property is again up for sale, leaving us to believe that the black male construction company owner was nothing more than a middleman for transferring the property that was recently owned by other black people to white hands, which is, I guess that's the way the game works around here, but it probably works that way in other places as well, too. I heard the story about the Uber threatening to leave cities if they raise minimum wages. These companies have been making this threat multiple times all over the country. And there was an article that I read earlier today that simply said that if every time a city has raised the minimum wage, even though Uber or the like has threatened to leave, they have stayed and they have paid those wages. Nevertheless, anyone, I imagine at some point maybe some of us have met or at least driven an Uber. Personally, I have not, but of course I've met people that have. People really don't understand how that stuff works financially. So what I mean by that, for example, is that Uber, they're treating you like you're a contract worker or you're your own business, but they say whether who you go pick up, when you go pick up someone, et cetera. And the major thing is that how you get your vehicle, there's one of two options. Either one, you own the vehicle, or two, you lease the vehicle, and of course that involves paying a car note or a leasing fee. And most people don't understand this, but like, especially if you own the vehicle, even though you're making whatever money you think you're making, you still got to pay for the maintenance, the insurance, the gas, and all the things that comes with owning your vehicle. So the company, Uber, that is hiring you, they're basically paying you whatever little fees they're paying you, but you are liquidating your vehicle and putting all those miles and maintenance issues on your car. And then, of course, most people use it when they get their money. Spend it because, of course, they got bills. And then when the tax season rolls around, they have to pay taxes on the income that they made. And chances are, because you make so little doing that type of job, you probably don't even have enough to pay your taxes. And a lot of people get into a really unfortunate financial situation with the government paying their taxes driving for Uber, something they don't talk about. All right, let's see. Next story. The only time I've been ever accused of anything in the workplace was when I was about 19 or 20 years old. I had a summer job away from college. Back then, the only kind of summer job I can get was, one of them I can get was like working with kids and like day camps and stuff like that. Not that that's a bad job, but this is my fault. This is me being younger, not knowing any better. I complained to the person who ran the program where I ended up. About the kind of job I wanted to do and that I didn't want to work with kids. Not that I personally have a problem with kids. I don't have a problem with kids. But he took it the wrong way. And I remember coming into that job for about a week, and what he did was he literally put me – I'm grown. I'm 19 years old, 19, 20 years old, and he literally put me in a corner away from the kids like I was going to do something harmful to the kids. That was one of the worst job situations that I've ever been in my entire life. And the person who ran this program was a black male. What I personally perceive to be a gay black male. Now, personally, I think, looking back in hindsight, maybe I'm wrong, but the way he treated me was a bit of projection. Like, he felt like I was going to do something wrong. Like, maybe he's been accused of doing something wrong, but that's the only time I've ever been accused of doing anything. And again, I've never done anything. I just let them know I wanted to do a different type of job, and he took it a certain type of way. And then also, something interesting happened at work. I've been in my job for almost 10 years, and within the last 2 weeks, for the first time since I've been there, they hired another black male planner, a recent graduate from Clemson University. The last time I saw a black male, he was an intern, and I think he only lasted for a summer, and then he probably went on to graduate or got a job somewhere else. I have no idea what happened to him. But I'm pleasantly surprised to see another black male in the office, maybe even shocked to a certain degree. And then when I added, my wife fell asleep. I guess it's been a long day. With that, I'll mute my line.
See there. You had got your act together and went to old Pitchfork Ben's alma mater. you know, would have been making probably $50,000 more and, you know, had a bigger office and everything. See, they keep saying that Clemson, man, they try to tell you, Clemson, go get you some correspondence courses or something. Look, watch how Black brothers' career is going to tell you. They went to Clemson, see? Now, I thought, non-Clemson dad, I thought he shared with us before, talking about being accused. He said that the white woman said that he tried to sabotage her with the deadline. Isn't that true? When he said he kept trying to say, hey, man, the deadline's about to go out. We got to apply for this money and blah, blah, blah. And then when they said, hey, old Don Clemson Gray, he didn't even share the information. He messed it as his
fault.
And then the white woman said, we got an old rapist. He's around here claiming to do yoga. Negroes don't do no yoga. Getting undressed and naked, and I came to knock on the door, and he went and tried to rape me. I got to run. Didn't that one happen too?
It happened as well too. I'm getting old, so there's something still in my mind. I put more of my mental capacities into learning new skills, not remembering every horrible thing that white people do. I need to do better.
That's why he's a valedictorian. There you go. That's right. That's right. You shake it off, let it go, learn new skills. That's what we need to solve this problem. Learn new skills. Do our best to let it go. We get mistreated, learn from it. Learn new skills. Jeez. Parenting does that too, having to do all that and take care of the child. Much obliged, non-Clemson dad. Let's see, though. I'm curious to see if Black brother with the Clemson degree, how they'll treat him in the office. Or if they just try and create conflict. That's normally the big one that they do, create conflict between victims of racism in the workplace. But amazing. Another Black male planner. Wonders never cease. Let's see. Number again. Oh, and he had told us the real estate folks, he said the course that they had, man, I'm not aware of too many Black architects either. I think they had a Black male who designed the African-American Cultural Heritage Center that's a part of the Smithsonian in Washington, D.C.
I will say, sorry to interrupt, the Black male who was hired in my office, his bachelor's degree is in architecture, but he got his master's in planning because he didn't like architecture.
Fascinating. I wonder why he didn't like architecture. Fascinating. That is fascinating. What were the demographics of the real estate course? Do you remember? In terms of
diversity real estate course. So every person in the course, there's about 18 of us. So every one of us are Black. And it's two-thirds female and one-third Black male.
Black.
And the people in the course have a variety of backgrounds. So, for example, I got planning and engineering in my background. But there's quite a couple of males in there, Black males, who have engineering backgrounds. One of them was a Black male appraiser, and for which my wife is looking into becoming an appraiser potentially if she thinks it's deemed it worthwhile. And a significant number of them also like realtors or realtors as well too. So yeah, take that for what it's worth. Basically, this is a course to try to get more diversity into the real estate development profession. And, you know, real estate development is not people traditionally go into, at least not as a traditional educational field. There might be something else you do, and then you become a developer. Like you might be a realtor. I'm sorry. You might go to school for planning. You might go to school for engineering. You might go to school for real estate. I think there's something called real estate studies, maybe. But there's a whole bunch of other things, and then you can end up in development. There's no set degree that you go to become a developer. At least that's what they tell us. And the idea is that because they want to diversify the profession, they started this course, and this is the second year that they're doing it in my region. And next year, they'll move it to the Charleston area for the third year.
Fascinating. Wow. Specifically designed to get some non-white people, lots of Black people, into real estate. That's bravo. Need more courses like that. And we did hear another teaspoon of black male privilege, it sounded like, with the numbers of the folks in the course, but to be expected there as well. Can't stop Leroy from carjacking people. But that's great. That's great. Wife, maybe Mama C, she'll get that appraising license or certification, whatever it is. That'll be awesome. Is there anything else I was saying? Oh, that was great info. I guess sad, but yeah, important info about the rideshare, because I suspect that that is true, where lots of people do not know all of the details about the income and how little money the folks who do all the rideshare, how little money they make and everything else. Yeah, that is not glorious work. Like I said, it was lots of dark people who were out hoping that they passed that initiative in Minnesota so that they can make a little bit more money, maybe cover some of the expenses on their vehicle and all the rest of it. Lots of non-white people, no surprise there. He had told us about the black construction worker. I just thought that was odd that they highlighted the black construction worker owning the property where he had told us before. It seemed like this was some sort of nefarious scheme, since the property's up for sale, for white people to finagle black property again. Very efficient they are at accomplishing this. Much obliged, non-Clemson dad. Brief cameo from 00 Dimples. Let's see. Other folks, if they have commentary, thoughts to share, I think he said, yeah, it's almost 2030. I think he said his numbers, the certification and everything, doing planning and all, his information was right online, as was the case for the other folks in his field with that certification. It's 2030, pretty much. I mean, that's what I was saying. Like, I don't think that there's much of a go around. I think in the workplace, they would probably have your personal information anyway. And even if they didn't, it's almost 2030, so how private do you think your info would be for white people if they really want to, you know, get your details? So, yeah, I don't think there's much of a go-around on that one. I think the best you could do is have a burner number and then just accept that they probably still have your other numbers as well. Anywho, we'll give folks another 5 minutes or so if they have additional observations, thoughts to share, anything in your work environment. If you have any suggestions to offer, we'll be here tomorrow for the compensatory call-in, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. They are still sharing reports about first Negro pilots, and we heard a number of those, even some of them for Women's History Month, which was, or I guess still ongoing, but it was a Women's Appreciation Day, that's what it was specifically, which was earlier this month. I guess that's a part of Women's History Month, but they still had lots more stories about the first Negro pilots and such. They don't even have that many black pilots, male or female, in this part of the world. We talked to Dr. Haddix at the end of last year about black people in aviation, or more specifically, racism, white supremacy in aviation, which explains the lack of black aviators. But that was the end of 2023. But man, try to learn a teaspoon about everything, and even try to get some of these jobs. I think he was saying that Mama C trying to, you know, or at least looking into being an appraiser. Some of those jobs where white people will be aging out and they're not being replaced because we don't have enough white people. See if we, individuals who are classified as not white, see if we can snare some of those jobs. If you have to get certifications and things of that nature, check. How long does it take to get certified? If you think you are going to be in the workforce for another 20 years, I don't know. Most of these certifications, it doesn't take 20 years. Most of them, it doesn't take 10 years. So, you know, hey, if you can get this, you know, what have you, and then have a good 15, 17 year run, you know, doing whatever this is, and this is something that you would enjoy, constructive. You don't think the robots are going to take this over within that 17 year time frame, or, you know, whatever the time frame, if you're even younger, then hey. But yeah, I would think about it, you know, maybe in those time frames. But yeah, see if you can take some of these jobs that are going to be vacated as white people get older. Aviation would be one of those. I think appraising, that'd probably be another one, but it's lots that are kind of specialized fields where white people are aging out and the machines are not taking everything just quite yet. Any hoodles, let's see. Last few, see if folks have their thoughts, observations to share for the workplace. Again, safety, I cannot emphasize enough. You always, in my view, folks can tell me if I'm in error, practicing safety is practicing counter-racism. And I think that's logic because, as I said before, the system of white supremacy racism is inherently unsafe. That's why you that's why you see things like what happened at Boeing all the time. Wheels falling off the plane and bolts and what they call it, cutting corners, that is so widespread. That's why the system of white supremacy is not safe. Mistreating people is not safe. So practicing safety, you're practicing counter-racism. I would say especially in the workplace, just practicing safety. And I'm sure even I just thought of that today with, you know, within the context of Boeing, but I'm really sure I start thinking of how that applies in, you know, different work settings. Doesn't matter what it is, construction, transportation, whatever it is, particularly lots of times they have Black people, non-white people in the most vulnerable positions. They talked about that all throughout COVID-19, in fact, and saying the so-called essential employees, in quotes, that they were disproportionately non-white people who were, you know, out there and you got to get COVID and, oh, well, if you got to come in contact with people who don't want to wear a mask and don't want to distance and others, okay, we'll bang on the pots for you, remember? That's what they did, all that goofiness in 2020 and 2021. But I mean, yeah, and that's what I'm saying. If we're practicing safety, we're going to make sure the so-called essential workers, we're going to do everything that we can to maximize safety for them. That's working against racism. That was the logic that I was using. But I did just think of that today, so I'll have to process it more. But I totally think that would be the case. I think you could just be the term that they'll use, a stickler, meaning someone that I'm, you know, always focused on and very serious. I don't mess around and do a whole lot of pussyfooting and cute metaphor. Oh, no. I'm always really serious and focused about safety in the workplace. If that's you, you are working against racism, I think. Even if you're the only non-white person there, like, hey, I'm going to make sure I'm safe. Hey, I don't even have to talk about it. We're not going to be ready. We're going to be safe. Workplace safety. I think you'll be working against it because, I mean, hey, there's nothing more unsafe in the known universe than the practice of white supremacy. Racing, we got bombs going on. Didn't Oppenheimer just tear off the Oscars and everything? It's nothing more unsafe than the system of white supremacy racism. Practicing safety in the workplace, generally speaking, you're going to be practicing counter-racism, maybe even keeping some non-white people safe, unharmed from racism. But I had to think about that for more. If anybody can see where it's something not logical about all that, you can let me know, because I just thought of that a few hours ago. But either way, safety. Let's see, other folks who dialed in, if you have a hand up, commentary to share, a caller at the courthouse in Florida should be with us as well.
Yes, sir. May I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Greetings to Gus, the host, the listeners and callers. I wanted to start out with when it comes to the information aspect, I do or I did have to provide my cell phone number and address as well, you know, just like with the ID and everything like that. I can't think of any kind of way to get around that as well. My next observation is that they are going to, and I think this is unjust and unsafe, and this is in the department that I work in, but Gus, I know you mentioned it was the title of a book, and I couldn't remember what the title of it is when it comes to thinking about, like, intuitions, the so-called gut feeling that you get about something on the job, and you just think, I'm thinking, I just don't want to, you know, participate in it. They were talking about doing some kind of marriage and passport Saturday on April the 6th, I think. And the time and the PTO, they're talking about doubling people's PTO or giving them the option to do overtime or get 8 hours of PTO for working 4 hours. And I think that's a way for them to help out a lot of whites, maybe one or two black people who are, who don't have sufficient PTO time. And I remember a few years ago, that used to be something, like you mentioned, stickler, I'm thinking of that word. They were very, strict on that. And me and a couple of other staff members, you know, try to keep that PTO time. But there are people who have been taking advantage. I guess it might have something to do with the COVID from like 2020 and how that's been going on a couple of years. And it seemed like they hadn't really been constructing and accruing more time. And I've even heard the HR person say that she thinks there are staff not, I'm thinking she means people that look like her, whites by majority, are taking advantage by working remote, or, you know, since they've been given the opportunity to work remotely and, you know, come up with ways to where they don't face any consequences for having low PTO. So that's been a thing too that I've been seeing going on around the office. But yeah, I just didn't get the interest to really participate in that. I just kind of saw that, like, them bringing in food and things like that. And I was thinking, man, like, what about, that was one of the things I was thinking, nobody else is getting that opportunity as well. And they actually put out a policy to where they said that when it was doing a form of overtime about a year or two ago, not everyone is going to get the opportunity. And I still been trying to look for that document. And that sounds even more unjust to me. But yeah, that's been something that's been going on. And there's a white man that usually writes those paragraphs in the newsletter. His demeanor has been changing, I guess changing meaning going from one thing to being a lot more withdrawn, not really walking around and speaking to people very much to be in a position that he's in. And I noticed that our side has fewer black people on it than the other area
the other side of the office, the courthouse. And he never really, almost never goes over there unless he's talking to the supervisors and the one black male court director. But it's more, it's a higher amount of black people on the other side of the courthouse. And him nor the chaos coordinator doesn't barely frequent that area. And I just think a lot of the white people there have been, I guess, angry with each other. I don't know if it may be some things going on about diversity and inclusion and all of these other kinds of discussions going on. Because, for instance, we had a meeting this morning, and it just seemed like it was, I just got that sense of things being phony and they're not really speaking in detail about too many things. It just seemed like there was kind of filler, if I can use that word. And they would just go around asking, did anybody have anything? And somebody had mentioned about they having court trials upstairs. And and it just, you know, it just didn't really seem that interesting. But I guess they just doing that for tradition or whatever. And I have one last comparison. This was another one of the white child, the black child comparison. So on Wednesday, there was a white blonde-haired baby, blonde-haired family that was getting their photos taken. And this baby was just very troublesome, disruptive, loud, noisy. And I didn't really hear nobody making any comments about, like, man, you need to take this baby outside or something. You know, this little toddler running around, not, you know, disobeying the mother, the father. And the black manager is, you know, conditioned and everything, of course, calling the baby her friend. So the baby outside in the hallway is all of a sudden starting to cry and make all of these whining noises. And she said, they made my friend cry. So I'm like, man, that's your friend. That's and the mother just totally just nearly fed up with the child. So I'm saying that to compare with the black male child that came in today, had a small, you know, fit, a tantrum or whatever with his mom. And even the mom was saying, because they give all of the children that come in there a sticker, a sheriff deputy sticker, a gold sticker, a star. And she's saying to the little boy that, hey, you know, if you don't change your act up or something, I'm a call those police out there on, you know? And I'm like, I'm still trying to find her document, and this is what she's saying. But the manager comes up and, I guess, ties his shoes or whatever. But she didn't show the same kind of interest and value in that child. And then even in fact, the bailiff came in and said, did anybody call 911? You know, and then, Gus, you know, I've mentioned the well-known panic button. So for some reason, at times, some of these bailiffs come in asking, did anybody press anything? The 911, that's what they're talking about, because the station is right up the hallway. So I don't know if somebody is pressing things or I don't know. But interestingly enough, when this black family was in there getting copied, the first bailiff comes in and asks, did anybody press anything? And then we said no. He walks out. Then another bailiff comes in and said they heard this child screaming, the black child. Okay. And he's trying to look like he wants to be pleasant. Say, hey, you're not listening to your mom. He said, I heard you all the way out in the hallway, you know. He said, what's going on, my man, right? That's how he addressed the little boy. He said, my man. He said, you're not listening to your mom? So you got to listen to your mom. And then you see, you know, he's kneeling down, talking to him and everything. And the child just looked just, you know, afraid, not really talking very much. And she's saying that he's just shy. And I just thought it was an interesting dynamic going on. So, you know, they got their copies and everything, and they walked out and they left. But that white child was very extremely loud, causing all kind of problems, running up into people's office. This black boy was just standing in one spot, but the white boy was running around, screaming, doing what he wants to do. Even the mom said that. So I didn't see no bailiff come in on that day. That was on Wednesday. Okay. So, you know, I think that's important to write those kind of things down in the notebook. And other than that, I forgot to add also the charter school situation with a coworker. She's been on the news, the local news, and I think white people are observing that as well, how she's speaking about the racism issue with that. So there's no telling how that situation is going to go as well. And that's all I have to share. Thanks for allowing me to speak.
That's hilarious. I'd forgotten about the white woman with this. She doesn't even have children in the chart. It's not like she has a direct, at this moment in life, maybe before, but unless my memory is bad, she doesn't even have children, you know. And I just, you know, got to look out for my next generation of suspected racist little people. The Gift of Fear. Gavin DeBecker read that one in the book club. He talks about, he has a whole chapter on in the workplace when you know, get that chill up your spine. Like, what did she just say? Do what? Go out to happy hour. What? What is he? The Gift of, he talks about that. Oh, yeah. Respect, even if you don't understand why you got that feeling or what's got, just respect. It's there for a reason. You can ask questions and figure it out as we go, but do not ignore that. Talks about O.J. Simpson in that book, too. I remember he had told us about that. That's another one that with my favorite D word, discretion. When the Rona started, unless my memory is bad two times, it was at the courthouse. We don't have no, you know, WFH. Ain't no working from home. Bring your hind parts into the office and let's get to work. And then as it moved forward, turned out, wait a minute, Gretchen been working from, what? Wait a minute, I thought you said it was no. And then it told, oh, well, some people do get to work from home. Seemed like the same thing had happened with the paid time off as well, where I do remember that. They were Nazis, you know, metaphor about the PTO. Like, whoa, 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 whoa. We are not sharing, divvying up and all that. And, you know, and then it was white. I think it was the same thing where it was not equal. And I think a white person got sick or wanted to take a wedding or their dog died or whatever. And, oh, man, I got some, here you go. And they, you know, changed all this around and everything else. They can switch it up, change it around. That's going to benefit them and what they want to do. And then even the audacity to have the white woman say, you know, I think some of our employees are abusing the PTO system. Which employees? Is it the folks in the segregated section? They're abusing the PTO. You don't have the means to find this. They got all the new technology he told us about. They just updated the system where people check in. So this is really, you know, high-tech, genius, sophisticated operation that they got running here and how they're bilking the PTO system? He said they got focused on bringing in food. We just got through, you know, the Rona. I don't know why that would be the focus anyway, and it shouldn't be, in my opinion, unless you know, are doing catering or something like that. You get paid. That's part of your job, is feeding and coordinating luncheons and such. But, I mean, we're just doing parties and whatever, knickknacks and things. Like, are you serious? Come on, man. When they told, and the same thing that I said in terms of discretion, that when they were talking about the PTO and all of that, but they said not everyone will get the opportunity. When they were talking about some of these special privileges, of whether it's working from home or the PTO or whatever it is, I said, man, the access to opportunities will be determined by whom and on what basis. And let's see if we get all that in writing. Like, man, that's what I mean, because they have so many patterns, practices of that sort of thing, where people normally classified as white, they get all of this special treatment, where it would seem, if this is not a violation, at least this is a deviation from standard operating procedure, where this is not what most employees get to do. But you're allowing Gretchen to do this. You're allowing Tad to do this. Why is that? It seems like it's only white people get this special benefit. What's even the protocol? And he said, can't even find the information. Why don't you at least make it public so we all know? Like, some people can work from home. If you have circumstances, bring us a doctor's note. We'll evaluate, blah, blah. At least that's something to work with. Like, oh, okay, we got sickness or what have you. There is a possibility. They don't even do that. Like, it's just a whisper that, you know. Some people. Like, come on. Come on. The avoiding the place with the most black people. Now, again, now a lot of this is, you know, the same patterns, because he had told us before that it was a number of black people, or excuse me, a number of white employees. They don't come to the segregated section where he and some of the other black people are. The air conditioning is broke on that side, and, you know, they got that question asking Negra, and he doesn't participate in that celebration. And he finds out this is a section with even more black people on a different side. Darkest of the jungle. You definitely don't. Stay away. He said, in fact, he even said that it was the white, I think it was the judge. They went and it was a nigger on the elevator. They said, whoa. Sorry about that, Leroy. I'm gonna wait. Catch the, yeah, go ahead. No. I'm good. Avoiding the Negra under all, apparently one, because if my memory, it could be again, could be, I don't think he said it was like 15. I think it was 20 black people. They don't have that many black people at the courthouse. It was one. Wasn't that, like, oh, I'm gonna got my purse and got his zipper. Yep. I'm good. I'm gonna catch the next one. Now the last one, man, I thought that, you know, immediately, like, man, they do have the panic button in here, fella. You know, they got black people who'll come in and tell you, and they might make you, you know, perform oral acts, you know, to keep you from being confined. You behave in here. Maybe you get outside and you throw a tantrum and yell. You didn't get what you want to eat, and, you know, you're a little grouchy. You didn't get enough rest. But, man, you straighten up and fly right when you go into the Florida courthouse. You know, you got the crackers and the panic button. Lo and behold, the bailiff ran in. Is it a problem? Is Leroy getting, I crack him right? Backtrack, he said, before the bailiff even ran, he said, the mom's there. Do you want me to call the police? Because I'll press the panic button. Man. I told y'all we got to get that black male privilege jig together, man. Like, victims guaranteed qualified. I don't have children. I'm certainly not, you know, here to offer a critique of anybody, a parent I've never met or anybody else. I don't have offspring. That's it. That is a widespread pattern where they call black people are criminalized for anything. breathing, blinking, walking, sitting. Certainly, you open your mouth up to cry, whimper, shout. Oh, man, you just about raped somebody. I mean, man, anything is liable to be criminalized, and everybody is kind of conditioned to think this way. Everybody. I remember this is back days before the cows came into existence, literally days, 2007. I was talking to a victim of white supremacy classified as black, and they said they were talking about a different black, but talking about a black male. And they said, this black person is on probation. And I said, dang, they on probation? Like, whoa. Did they commit a crime? Did they rape someone? Were they selling crack cocaine? They said, no, I didn't think they should have been at that party dancing. They were doing a little too much on the floor. I said, dang, they on probation. Like, good God, we all this talk, we got to do criminal justice reform. And dang, the way that we talk about black and black privileged black males in particular, it's always they're criminal, even when they haven't done anything. And it starts that young. He even said, they said that about Tamir Rice. Is it, we got a 35-year-old black dude with a rifle. He's got a beard, a few gray hairs, and pow, they shot him and said, oh, dang, wait a minute. Oh, he's 11. Dang. He looked like he was about 35, though. Are you sure? Dang. I thought he was 35. He said the guard came in, the bailiff. You sure y'all didn't press the panic button? What's going on, my man? Behave yourself there. Get your like, hey, wait a minute. He can't even. I don't even have my bowels straight, sir. I gotta have a pamper and everything. Like it. The man is here. I am for sure. The baby. That's on Dr. Welsing's list. Baby. Still getting my act together. Ain't even got my bowels straight. That's why I'm having a fit now, maybe. Come on, man. I wouldn't even want my child exposed to that sort of environment. Like, Jesus Christ. Like, you gotta have two? I don't even want you talking. Like, get away from all of us. Like, man, back up. You got the Rona? Thank you, sir. We're fine. He's fine. We're fine. He's a little cranky from what I said, his nap. He's got to go to the bathroom. Bowels are loose. We're fine. Thank you. They didn't do all that run out. Oh, who upset my little buddy? Oh, do you want a sucker? What can we do, my little friend? They didn't do all that. They didn't do it. I'm going to stay near the panic button because I know Leroy gets out of hand if he tries. And even we've heard this before. He told us. They had grown white people who came down there and did the exact same thing that that little white urchin did, ran all over the courthouse, did everything that they wanted to do, ran in the restricted areas, and I'm a sovereign citizen, you don't tell me what to do, and nobody hit the panic button. Nobody went, bailiff! Oh, my Lord. They said, I think some of these folks, they had even talked about this in advance. Like, we got these unruly white folks. They come up here and do rah, rah, rah. They say they had the memo and everything. Nobody. I've been practicing my UFC. I'm going to get my Brazilian wrestling and pow, do my. They didn't do none of that. They didn't do none of that. They got to run all over it. Rah, rah, rah. You give me the documents right now. You're hiding them and I'm solving the center. And DeSantis told me, rah, rah. They ran all over. Man, imagine Leroy. Apparently, imagine a black child just coming down and they whimper a little bit. You got me. Whoa. You might. That's the sort of thing Dorothy Roberts talked about. You could end up in foster care, buddy. You know about Devontae Hart? You want to go home with a lesbian group of white women? Hope they don't poison you before they drive you off the cliff? Zip it, buddy. Get these documents. Get these copies. Hopefully our black brother will hook us up promptly and we can get out of here. Hurry up with the copies, man. Get out of here. Like, man. But that's what I said. I don't have a criticism for the young lady. She's being a black mom and all that. I don't have a criticism at all. I'm just, that's the environment that we're in. Isn't that atrocious? Man. System of white supremacy, racism. You're a criminal at every moment. birth, all that. Matter of fact, and you got the whole spectrum right there at the courthouse. So we got that. The little fella came in. He said it was an elderly black dude. So you get all the way cradle to the grave. I got my gray hairs. He said he happened to be a little bit older. And he was walking in with his wife. Privileged black male. Whoa. Wait a minute. Whoa. When he calmed down, it's Jesus Christ. Lord, they were ready to shoot him or billy club him, all of it. Maybe they were going to shank him too. And he said, Lord Jesus, I'm about to die. Give me my blood pressure medication. Jesus Christ. Woo. It's probably because I'm tall. I'm big, you know. I'm privileged. That's probably. And then after he calmed down, he said, you know, I see tall white people and they don't, you know, I think might have been racist. He said what he had to whisper. Was that an elderly black person? My memory bad. Was he older?
Yes, sir. He said he came up there. Now, he said he was 61 and they pulled up something that he did at 20 or 21 years old. And then he said that he was, 6'3". And he said, but it was a white dude that came in and he said they didn't, you know, they didn't ask him to hold his hands up. So he said, I think it was, yeah. He said, you know, I don't, but it was only just, it was only just, the coworker, another black person. And that's exactly how he said it. He said, I don't want to say this too loud, but I think it was racist. And then another thing I thought about was, I'm going to say his name, Carl Hayes. That was the black male that, and another victim shared with me that it was a white woman that started this, and called to the other side, and a clique member, of course, pressed the panic button. And he walked over and we were about to help him. And then I see five white men jump on this guy. And, you know, he was calling a white boy and he said, I ain't about to, you know, suck no penis to get out of jail. So he just walked in there. And I remember hearing that they did press that button up there, but he just only just walked in there and we had his file. So that was the last time we seen him. So, yeah, all of that happened in that same spot.
Full spectrum. So you got, at the beginning, like I said, cradle, criminal, panic button, man. And that's even more embarrassing because I don't think any of those other five, I don't think any of them, man. I don't even think he said sir to any of them. Get back, criminal. Get back. Get over there. But the child, the baby, literally indict. Man, behave yourself. Do I get? And then everybody else is, you know, we'll shoot you and stab you on the spot if you don't get sodomized or whatever. We got to get that black male privilege jig, man. I'm telling you, by Juneteenth, we get that thing down and we'll go in the election. They'll call us out, man. Trump, when he comes to do the rallies and things, he bring us to the Republican National Convention. We do the black male privilege jig. They'll get Tom Scott. We get Senator Scott to come out and do the jig. Bam. He can say, man, if I had this, I could have been. Anyway, maybe he'll be vice president. Anyway, much a black man. Do you see that, though? That would be something that I would think about. If you're going to go out in public, you got your black child, like, man, do I want to expose them? I would have to think about that, like, everywhere, thinking how things could be inappropriate here, or what sort of mistreatment do, what do I want to expose them to? Like, they got bailiffs here, They got a panic button in the court. Jesus. That's why I said I have zero criticisms. The young lady, attempted mom, doing the best that she can. No criticisms. Just, man, that is so tough. Man, having children in the system of white supremacy racism, that's what you can prepare. Lots of episodes like that. Any hoodles. Much obliged, good sir. Make sure we didn't miss anyone. We'll be here tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific, for the compensatory call-in, catch up on news tidbits from the last 7 days or so. Whew, man, oh man, pitiful. Much obliged for the folks tuning in, hopefully worthy of your time and energy. No gossiping. Sobriety would be best. No gossiping. That is in the 10 stops, and that is so rife in the workplace, just sitting around and talking bad about really everybody, because it's not like this is just exclusively where they talk bad about non-white people. White people do a lot of gossiping about other white people. That doesn't make it any better. That does not help us solve any problem. That's the same sort of thing where I said before, I'm not involved in any of this. Don't come at me, you know, about no gossip, and you want to talk bad about any of our coworkers or whatever. Please. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. No name calling, no gossiping, no throwaway offspring. Cal signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
your
brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
Shut I'm a up. Victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.